back at the Carrier Dome, just about set for the opening kick as we welcome our third member of the crew on the sidelines, Dave Ryan.
Well, Dave, thanks. The number 44, the Syracuse jersey, and Syracuse football go hand in hand. They have for a long time. It all started with the legends who wore that jersey number, and Jim Brown, Floyd Little, and Ernie Davis. Rob Conrad, the senior fullback, has tried to continue the legacy, but it hasn't been easy. He was injured much of last year, and fans here became disappointed he wasn't living up to the tradition of the great number 44 players. Well, guys, he had a vigorous offseason workout program, dropped about 20 pounds. He's a lean, mean, powerful 250 pounds in the best shape of his career. Dave and Bill, it's never easy to wear number 44 when they change the zip code right here in the school, the last two digits to 44.
Can't hide if you got that shirt, not in Syracuse, New York. Syracuse has won the toss and elected to receive the kick from Jeff Hall. And back deep for the Orangemen, Steamster Kevin Johnson, who returned the opening kick of the season last year for a touchdown against Wisconsin, and Kyle McIntosh. This is Johnson. Short return of a short kick, knocked out at the 36-yard line. And the Syracuse offense goes to work. One of the most potent in the country, senior quarterback Donovan McNabb, Rod Conrad, and last year's leading rusher, 945 yards for Kyle McIntosh, the tailback. Receiving crew, Brominski, new tight end. Spotwood, second team All-America last year as a punt returner. He's dangerous, as is Johnson. They both averaged 19 yards per catch last year. Vanowitz Kiernan, a third-year starter. He's down 40 pounds since the fiesta. Bowen O'Donnell and Keelon are up front for the Orangemen. 9-4 a year ago. 9 wins, one more year would be viewed as a big disappointment. High hopes, high expectations, and right away they go to the option, and a keeper for about 4 for Quinton for Donovan McNabb, who is brought down across the 40-yard line. Tennessee defensively, Ellis, Coleman, Darwin Walker, a transfer from NC State, who had 6 sacks a year ago, and Corey Terry, a returning starter, up front. Westmoreland Wilson, who moves from outside backer into the middle to replace the departed Leonard Little and Raynock Thompson. And in the secondary, lots of speed, especially Dwayne Goodrich, who they call the Magnet. Why? He has 6 fumble recoveries, 6 interceptions, 2 of which he has brought back for touchdowns in his first 2 years. High on second down, and McNabb complete to Conrad, shuts the tackle, and has the Syracuse first down, a pickup of 9 before he's driven out by Al Wilson.
Rob Conrad, number 44. Such a significant number here in the Syracuse lore, runs right through the tackle of Al Wilson, number 27, the middle linebacker for Tennessee. That is not easy to do. A big, not just a big guy, but fast and powerful, number 44, Rob Conrad, on his first handling of the ball today.
Look for lots of formations, lots of different elements of offense from the Orangemen today. This is Kyle McIntosh trying to get outside on Hurts' first carry, about 2. And the free safety up for the stop, Deion Grant.
And the Tennessee coaches, Dave, have told us that they think Deion Grant can be the next Dale Carter. Now, that is a mouthful. Dale Carter, the former number 1 draft choice who went on to the Kansas City Chiefs, and really one of the real momentum changers I've ever seen in college football. So Deion has made his first tackle of the year.
Grant replacing Corey Gaines at that spot for Tennessee. McIntosh gets 3 into Tennessee territory for 2nd and 7. And off the play fake. Marker is down. McNabb incomplete. Juggled and dropped by Kevin Johnson.
The location of the flag is not good news for Syracuse. It would normally tend to indicate holding. I didn't see the infraction, but we'll get the signal here in just a moment. The other end of the play, Kevin Johnson, almost never do you see Kevin take his eye off the football. He's a polished receiver, a former quarterback, who has the ingredients of the other great receivers that have left Syracuse and gone on to fame and fortune in the National Football League.
Steve Shaw, referee. Indication against Syracuse. Donovan McNabb last year, 7th in the country in passing. He is already second all-time in Syracuse history in passing yards and percentage, first in touchdown passes.
Pass interference on the offense. That's 15 yards, and we will repeat second down.
But McNabb isn't looking at stats. I don't think his fans are looking at stats. The only stat that will determine whether he thinks he's had a successful senior year, and Paul Pasqualoni would agree with this, is whether they get more wins than in the past.
Absolutely, and it's really a tribute to Donovan and his character that he's not intrigued by all these records he's setting. And that was a really unusual call. Offensive pass interference, I can't see where it could have been called.
Three wides. And under a little pressure again, first catch by Quentin Spotwood. And the speedster wide out across the 40, Wilson from middle backer, patrolling that area of the field to make the hit.
Quentin Spotwood, who tied an NCAA record a year ago, looks the ball right into his hands, which is his wont. He returned four punts for touchdowns a year ago. Al Wilson got him on the ground, but just barely.
Terrific numbers, and they say maybe the best set of hands they've ever had at Syracuse. They put him in some lofty company as well. They need 17 on third down. McNabb stepping away from the pressure and on his knees, but short of the first down, the catch by Kevin Johnson. That was as impressive as the drop was disappointing. And they come up just shy of the marker. The fans say, let's go for it with less than one needed.
Dexter McNabb does not like to be characterized as just a master of improvisation, but he is that. This is what drives opposing defenses crazy. It's almost impossible for one man to get him on the ground. And he's not trying to run. He's trying to find a receiver down the field. And here we are with the first critical situation in this game, fourth and short, and Syracuse is making a statement to the Tennessee defense. We're coming after you at the wishbone.
This is their ham bone, ham as in hammer. They have as big a backfield as they can get, and right now they're a confused backfield. And they have to use a timeout. When we come back, they'll try to convert the fourth and less than one, scoreless early in the Carrier Dome. Orangemen had to use the timeout. A little confusion as they went to their handbook.
Not unusual early in the year, but really it shouldn't have happened. We watched them practice Thursday, and they did all those things perfectly, moving from the wishbone to the ham bone with a wing, terminology that they use. And look at the size of the back, 250, 252. And D. Brown is the little guy at 203. This is power football, more than likely. The other thing they could run is the triple option, but most likely the inside belly.
Conrad gets the call and gets the first. Boy, there aren't many defenses that can match that kind of power exploding from the backfield.
The lineman will block down with the exception of the tight end. The lead block by D. Brown, number 6, and by Sedano. And here comes the big man, number 44, Rob Conrad, on the inside belly right behind B. Brown for the first down.
It's not quite the days of Refrigerator Perry as fullback for the old Bears, but it'll do for now. It got the job done, and it kept the drive alive.
Somehow it doesn't bounce quite as this field doesn't.
Rather, an equipment violation on the offense. That'll be a charge timeout.
Boy, and that's their second. Somebody's uniform is not up to regulation standards, and so another timeout. 11:09, first drive still in progress. Paul Pasqualoni elected to receive, wanted all the early momentum behind him, and they've kind of stuffed their own progress with two timeouts, one because of an apparent uniform violation by Kevin Johnson, who pulled his pants down below his knees. They're pretty picky about that this year. Give up to the left side for Kyle McIntosh, the tailback. Fred White from strong safety was there for the Tennessee tackle. Now, how frustrating that must be for a head coach.
Yeah, and head coaches like Paul cover every detail with their team, such as pull your knee pads down so that they cover your knee. That's probably what happened. The officials are very serious about the equipment violations because it's all for player safety. You can't wear your football pants like Bermuda shorts and protect your knees properly.
Second down, and Johnson unable to shed a tackle. Looked like he might be able to high step over Steve Johnson. Johnson bringing him down, though, inside the 35, and it'll be third and about four. Johnson second last year behind Spotwood. He caught 32. They both averaged an eye-popping 19 yards per catch. You have one receiver on your team that is that much of a deep threat. You have something. They have two.
You have something very special. And just 3 years ago, Johnson was a candidate for this quarterback job. So he's pitched in there unselfishly and become an outstanding player at his position.
Ninth play of this stop and start drive. It'll end right here. McNabb lost it, got it back. But his recovery loses all the way back to the 46-yard line. Al Wilson bearing down on him from middle backer.
A superb strategy by the Tennessee defense brings the middle linebacker on an outside blitz. A lineman is required to get out from inside. Al Wilson's going to come in this direction and come from the outside. There is not a blocker for him. He is unblocked. There he comes. And this is one of the few times McNabb is brought down by one player and is very fortunate to recover his own fumble.
Or he's going to have to kick Doug Duncan. With a touchback, Deion Grant allowing that one to go 46 yards. It'll net just 26, and the Volunteers, for the first time this year, under T. Martin's leadership at quarterback. And they'll go from their 20. Peyton Manning era ending. T. Martin's era begins today. And in the backfield with him, Bryson the fullback, Jamal Lewis, who led the SEC and all freshmen in the country last year, 1,300 yards. Diagu at tight end. Price and Copeland, speedy wideouts, at least as fast as those from Syracuse. Clifton, Hamilton, Riley moved from left guard to center this year with Coleman and Rito. Three 300 pounders in front of Martin. Rolls, looks long for Price, out of bounds. And so much for breaking T in slowly. They go right to the deep ball on first down. The Syracuse defense with a lot of new faces. Pilon, Simpkins, Coleman, and Donald Dinkins, who they feel is their best D lineman, the most versatile. They need him to have a big year. Linebacking crew for the Orangemen, Greenwood, Bullock, their top returnee at in the tackles from a year ago. He replaces Antoine Pons. Will Allen expected to be a three-year starter. He's a sophomore, a big corner. Lewis into the secondary, where Nash took the first contact, and he'll feel that for a few days. 30-yard pickup. Rito from right tackle springing Jamal Lewis for his first big gainer of the year.
And a superb block by the tight end right here. Eric Diagu stays on his man, occupies Greenwood, and gives his runner a chance to get loose. And you're seeing the leading freshman runner from a year ago in the United States. He's a load.
Those numbers, despite the fact he didn't play much his first three games. Martin off the play fake to Lewis. Rowland looking deep again. Ball is caught and near the 15-yard line. The first catch by Copeland. 33 yards. Martin to Copeland.
T. Martin is superbly prepared intellectually, emotionally. Now look at his physical ability. He has the ability, superb fake. He's on the corner now. Shoulders turned perfectly. You must get those shoulders square to make a throw as accurately as he made here. Good execution on the corner route by Copeland, and big play.
Lewis, a lone setback. Boy, Nash shows how hard it is, almost impossible to bring him down by yourself, and especially if you grab him high like Phil Nash tried to.
Yeah, but Phil's smart, just to latch on to Lewis and wait for help. He's got speed coming inside out. If you try to take him back thigh high, you may be unconscious and he may be in the end zone. So that was a wise move by the the new free safety, Phil Nash, number 10 for Syracuse.
Some of the comparisons you already hear about Jamal Lewis, they'll throw names like Herschel Walker and Bo Jackson at you. Maybe by the end of his career, he will surpass even their numbers. He's got a great start. Martin with an option keeper. And Tennessee has worked long and hard, Bill, the offseason, on trying to add that aspect to their attack, which obviously you weren't going to see much with Peyton Manning back then.
That's right. Coach Fulmer told us, now, we're not going to try to become Nebraska. Phillip knows that he's got a rare commodity and all the ingredients that T. Martin brings to this position. So they're going to run some option, and they actually took the green shirt off and hit him in spring practice so that to toughen him up.
Fans on their feet on the third and six. Martin on the roll, caught, touchdown. Peerless Price from T. Martin for the first Tennessee touchdown of the year.
Martin showed us he could roll to his left, get his shoulders around and throw accurately. Now he shows us he can roll to his right and do precisely the same thing. I'm sure Peerless didn't mean for that ball to hit him in the face mask, but he still hemmed it up. Everybody gets excited in their first outing and in their first catch.
Extra point attempt is good by Jeff Hall. 7-0, Volunteers. Bill Fulmer, at the dawn of the T. Martin era, a happy man so far, as well he should be. Phil Fulmer's Volunteer offense showing a little bit of everything they feel they can do in the T. Martin era of offense. A little rollout, little option, deep ball, short ball, and he executed just about everything flawlessly.
Yeah, his only mistake was the deep ball, which would have been a touchdown on the first play. The ball tends to spiral if you're right-handed on the right sideline, and it'll ease itself out of bounds, and that's what happened on that first throw. But since then, he's been perfect.
Ball hung the first one short, booms this one about 4 yards back, bringing it out. Kyle McIntosh, not a good decision. Chris Ramsour, first man up for Tennessee on just a 14-yard return. Well, on his first drive, Donovan McNabb had the Orangemen offense going, and then they shot themselves at their own foot twice with indecision. The one timeout on the fourth down, they were charged with another one because of the uniform violation.
And then we just saw indecision in the kicking game by McIntosh. That's an incredible mistake for a well-coached football team like Syracuse that does such a good job in special teams. Field position very poor here.
They come up McNabb on first down, three in the backfield.
McNabb's got to come out of a hole here.
Option pitch, McIntosh. I'm not even sure if he got back to the line of scrimmage. That time they hid Kevin Johnson back there among those three in the backfield behind McNabb. Jeff Coleman, Steve Johnson. Quick enough to come up and read the option pitch.
The idea in option football is to confuse the read of the quarterback so that not everybody's blocked and to get your free safety into the alley. That's what happened. To take a step back, the poor field position was caused by a mistake in the kicking game, and they are now deep in a hole having to operate without good field position, which is one of the most important things in the beginning of a drive.
This time out of the eye, Darryl Daniel went in motion. And McNabb hit, got it back, his second recovered fumble, leaps over a defender and makes his way out to the 20. That may be the best play we see all year from Donovan McNabb to salvage about 5 yards.
The ballet at work. Watch this man's feet, his body control, and his upper body strength. That doesn't just happen because of natural ability. That's months and work, months of agility, hard work, upper body strength. And Donovan was saying, it's just another day at the office.
He gave up basketball last spring, but he remembers how to jump. 11 rushing touchdowns in his career. That one sets up third and four. This time has some time, but not on the same page. Darryl Daniel, the nearest target, but he turned in. The ball went out.
Looking at the overall picture in this game, what we're seeing is Syracuse making the small errors that stop drives, Tennessee making the big plays to keep drives alive and to take it in the end zone.
So again, having to kick it away will be Duncan. Jermaine Copeland figures to set Tennessee up in good shape as he waits near his 40.
And they're doubling both the outside coverage men, the gunners, which will make it very difficult for Syracuse to get good coverage here.
Excellent kick there. Wow, Copeland all the way back at his 20. And down to his 24, a 58-yarder by Duncan.
Yeah, and just as important, Will Allen ran right by the two guys supposed to block him.
Tomorrow night at 8:15 Eastern, ESPN debuts its first full season of Sunday Night Football. Week one matches up the age-old rivals, the Oakland Raiders, and the Kansas City Chiefs, the reigning AFC West champs. And in Monday Night Football, Mile High Stadium in Denver, John Elway and the Super Bowl champion Broncos against the defending AFC East champs, New England. On to ABC. That time, early movement by Donald Dinkins, who immediately pointed at the man he felt drew him offsides for Tennessee.
Dead ball foul. False start on the offense. 5 yards,
this is the fourth straight time that Tennessee's lined up in two tight ends, and one of their tight ends, number 82, Eric Diagu, made a critical mistake. Coaches call those drive killers. But in the previous drive, this offensive line of Tennessee dominated the defense of Syracuse.
Martin, another roll off play action. And intended upfield for Cedric Wilson. Tight coverage that time. He felt, in fact, maybe too tight by Will Allen.
Good defense, good coverage, and good contain. Someone is responsible to contain the quarterback when he gets on the corner. If that does not happen, and if the receiver is covered, if that happens and the receiver is covered, rather, then the offense has no play, and that's what happened. Good defense by Syracuse on the sprint, and that's the first time they've defensed it properly.
Offset eye, both wides near side on second and 15. Wilson started in, cuts out, breaks a tackle again, but held to a short gain to the 20, ended by the middle backer, Keith Bullock, who has some rather large shoes to fill as he replaces Antoine Pons this year. That Syracuse defense missing a lot of guys who are now in the NFL.
And just as surely as this offensive line dominated the first drive, they are being whipped this time. They were coming off the ball and blowing Syracuse linemen back. No dice this time. Good contain. Jason Coles forces him outside, and Bullock, number 33, is there to make the play.
High snap and a keeper. But Martin out of the shotgun, tripped up for maybe one. David Byrd coming up from corner.
Syracuse showing that they are ready to play some defense in this game. You'll see an unblocked rusher, David Byrd, coming off the corner. He forces T. Martin up inside where the pursuit catches him. And Syracuse has their first stop.
And Syracuse is a threat anytime Quentin Spotwood drops back deep, as he does here. The punt by David Leverton. Spotwood, who set an NCAA mark last year, returning four punts for touchdowns. Let's send it down to Dave Ryan.
Well, guys, a pretty amazing story with David Byrd. He was here for a season as a freshman a couple years back, and then decided he was wanted to be a track and field star permanently. The way he had to come through high school, he was a very good track athlete. Said he didn't have the passion and the heart to play college football anymore, so he left the program for a year. But then watched the Fiesta Bowl, and it was pretty much an agony, guys. He wanted to come back to the Syracuse program, so he asked the coaches if he could have a scholarship back. Defensive coordinator Josh Gileone said during the spring drills, the team only had seven offensive backs and just two cornerbacks. It was like having a free agent drop down from heaven. They'd love to have him back. He made a big play today.
Well, this call has come from some other source. This is an illegal block, which is going to move first down back to the 28-yard line. But that really is quite a nice gift for George De Leon as he moves to the defensive side of the ball. Longtime offensive assistant under Paul Pasqualoni, credited with installing the versatility of the Syracuse attack, and now he's the defensive coordinator.
That's right. If he knows what gives offenses trouble, if he doesn't know, nobody does.
Rob Conrad for no gain. Let's see what's happening in Iowa. An update from Larry Beal.
All right, thanks, Dave. Iowa and Central Michigan. It's the freshman, Khalil Hill, for the Hawkeyes. Breaking a tackle. And you don't see a lot of Chippewas in the picture right now. 61 yards, weaving his way to the end zone. 7-0 Hawkeyes, first quarter.
Very Tim Dwight-like.
I'll tell you, I hope there's some Tim Dwights out there, because I had more fun watching him than anybody I've ever watched play football.
Ball at the line from McNabb. Three wides, draw play. D. Brown getting a series, replacing McIntosh at tailback, and he's out to the 34, sophomore from Altamonte Springs, Florida.
One thing we have to note that's really an aberration for Syracuse is a series of mistakes in the kicking game. The previous mistake took 15 yards of field position. It was blocking below the waist in a kicking situation. And I'm sure Coach Pasqualoni will get him on the sideline and get that corrected immediately, if not at halftime.
So as they try to get something established on the offensive side, big third and a long three here. Need to get the 38. McNabb, second target. Catch is made by Brown. Net rather rudely at the 36 by Raynock Thompson. And the weak side backer with the stop a couple of yards shy of the first, and another two quick series for McNabb.
Yeah, in watching the Nebraska Orange Bowl game with Tennessee last year, the guy that jumped out at me was Raynock Thompson. He's all over the field. The definition of pursuit is to sprint to the football and to arrive there in a very foul mood. He does that with regularity. That was a big play in pursuit. Otherwise, D would have made the first down and the drive would have been sustained.
Well, Duncan last time busted a 58-yarder. Ball's come after him. End over end down to Copeland. And Jermaine, try as he might, unable to make anybody miss, and a marker is down after a 41-yard punt. Lost one on the return. Early indication might be a face mask.
Yep, I think it was Klaus, the backup middle linebacker, who got a hold of the face mask there. And they didn't see him do it. They did see a Tennessee player block in the back. And here we are with two of the most powerful, traditional special teams powers showing the signs of early nervousness by making mistake after mistake in the kicking game. And the field position reflects it.
The ball's hit with an illegal block. And they start back at their own 12. Keep it on the ground for Lewis, who first time he touched it today broke a 30-yarder, and since then fairly well bottled up.
Yeah, number 33, Keith Bullock, the middle linebacker, is a former safety. Tough guy, but not as bulky as you might like at middle linebacker, and his coaches had a little concern about whether he would be able to handle the consistent pounding. He is a leader, and he's obviously up to the task thus far.
Lewis netting just 2 yards on his three carries since the 30-yarder. Well, they'll try him again. A little better result this time. Out to the 19-yard line on what will end the first quarter. Tennessee on its first drive with T. Martin at the controls. Very impressive. They got the touchdown pass to Peerless Price and lead at the end of one at the sold-out Carrier Dome in Syracuse, 7-0. That was a proud defensive unit a year ago, 10th nationally in scoring defense, but seven starters had to be replaced from that group, and the early returns, Bill, were not very good. They got overpowered on the first Tennessee series. They've adjusted pretty well since then.
They've been brilliant since then. Here's a big play here, 33.
Martin retreating and incomplete. Intended for his fullback, Sean Bryson, who is an excellent receiver out of the backfield. That one, though, jarred loose by Jason Poles, the strong safety.
The rush is coming. Good job by the quarterback, T. Martin, on the screen. And yet Poles was in man coverage, number seven. Made the stop, knocked the ball loose behind the line of scrimmage before it was controlled by Sean Bryson, number 24, the fullback.
Well, they come after Leverton. Spotwood will have not much room to try and turn that corner, though, and in fact retreats inside his 40-yard line. Lost five on the return of a 37-yard punt. The chase for history continues tomorrow as Mark McGwire and the Cardinals head to Cincinnati to take on the Reds if McGwire's homer total is 59 or less. Tune into ESPN2 at 2 p.m. Eastern for full coverage of the game. That's 59 or less or more than 62. And he is at 59 and counting. Boy, and every time it looks like the Orangemen will benefit from field position, they march backwards.
I'm just shocked, to tell you the truth. These are two of the most publicized, well-coached special teams units in America, and they're making mistake after mistake after mistake, especially Syracuse. Yet another penalty, a flipping penalty, on that return.
McNabb with McIntosh back in, buried. Boy, what a quick reacting Raymond Thompson. That was up from weak side backer. Their most experienced outside backer. And they allow Al Wilson to move outside into the middle because Raynock patrols the corner.
Yeah, if you got somebody like Raynock, number 46 right here, playing off the blocker, boom. I mean, he's just a great football player already. I thought he was terrific last year. He's obviously done his homework, and he's ready today. He's already got four tackles. He has another tackle on special teams. He made the tackle in Spotwood on the previous punt.
Just a junior out of New Orleans. Loss of four for McIntosh. McNabb off the rollout. A little bit underthrown and coming back to make the catch of Spotwood. If he doesn't have to dive to make that one, he might have a first down.
Yeah, Dexter. Donovan would like to have that one back. He tried to aim it and he threw it too low. We've got a player down there. Looks like he's okay.
Sean Ellis.
Yep, Sean Ellis is up. He's okay. He's moving around. He was blocked very hard by Rob Conrad, number 44, who's not just a ball carrier, but proved that he can hit the big guys. It was a good legal block, and he knocked number 93, Sean Ellis, to the ground to allow Donovan a chance to throw that ball.
Ellis, who had to miss the spring because he fractured a hip in a car accident. But he rehabbed it to the point that it's now stronger than his other hip. So hopefully this is not anything having to do with that recurring hip. Third and seven. Need to get just inside the 40. Rolling the other way, McNabb on target. And the catch made for the first down by Darryl Daniel. Good for 12 yards in front of Dwayne Goodrich.
This is an all-out blitz by the Tennessee defense. They bring a spate of linebackers and safeties into every gap here. An excellent call, anticipating the blitz by George Daly, well, rather by the Syracuse offensive coordinator. I'm so used to George being Syracuse's offensive coordinator. He's up there on the other side of the ball. Good ball call by Kevin Rogers there, the offensive coordinator, to make the first down.
Lots of different sets this time. In the one back, Conrad. This is a reverse for Johnson. Tennessee not fooled, but it's blocked pretty well, and he salvages a couple of yards out of this. And they also paid for it with what the Syracuse fans thought might have been a late hit.
Yeah, I'll tell you what, too, right here. Stroop gets away with some holding and some blocking from the rear. I'm sure the official would say it was continuous contact, but he locked up on something there. He had a little piece of shoulder pad or jersey, and Mr. Stroop dodged a bullet there. Darrell got away with a hold and a clip on the same play to get a 6-yard gain.
That's not easy. You can get away with one penalty, but a double-double.
I don't recall getting away with either one of them in my career.
So second and 4. And again, only Conrad of the Dashies. Another short toss. And Daniel immediately is wrapped up by Steve Johnson. That one was almost thrown too late and was real close to being interceptable for Johnson. But as it is, it's enough for the first down for Daniel.
Yes, indeed. But Johnson was in man coverage. And I want you to understand that the coaches, Kevin Rogers, saw that. And it won't be long before you'll see an out and up against number 34 because he's playing so tightly. Steve Johnson has an awful lot of confidence in his speed, but these guys can fly. Trust me, they'll test him deep soon.
Syracuse hoping to disorient the Tennessee defensive rhythm with some options and then hit him occasionally with the long ball. This has happened 3 times now where McNabb has had to recover his own fumble. Now, the first 2 times, it was as he was dropping back to pass. This time, he never had the clean exchange from center.
Center quarterback exchange is the fundamental play in all of football. There is no excuse ever for this play to occur. This ball has to happen. We had goals, most coaches have goals, of 0 missed center quarterback exchanges for the season. You've got a veteran center in Corey Bowen, number 55, a veteran quarterback in Donovan McNabb, and the ball never got in Donovan's hands. That's inexcusable. You can't let that happen.
I'm not sure how Jeff Coleman, the DT, 92, didn't end up with that because he had his hands on it first. McNabb took it away. Here's Conrad with room to ramble. Rob Conrad has a first down at the Tennessee 30. 18 yards for Conrad.
A beautifully executed screen, and this is something Conrad loves to do. Scott Kiernan, you can barely see him, number 61, the left guard, will come right out here after he sets and makes his initial pass protection, and he'll have a key block. Boom, right there. Beautiful. The big man is off and running. He is not just a big fullback. He can run like a tailback, but he weighs 250. Well executed.
Conrad slipping through the middle. And a couple. Let's check in on the sideline with Rhino.
Well, Dave, we thank our brethren at ESPN, the magazine, for our In the Crosshairs weekly feature. This week it's on Syracuse quarterback Donovan McNabb. Look at the awards this guy's piled up already. First team All Big East 3 straight years. The Syracuse career list, he's first or second in 12 offensive categories, including career touchdown passes, career passing yards, and passing efficiency as well. And this summer, guys, as if that wasn't enough, he also served as an intern at the Chicago Stock Exchange, spent several weeks this summer working in the marketing department, and was a market reporter at the Chicago Mercantile Exchange as well. Quite an interesting individual. A lot of talent for Don McNabb.
He'll probably have a lot of money to count in another year. Right now, they're checking on the injured Tennessee defender, Sean Johnson, who is Al Wilson's backup at middle linebacker. So a timeout early in the second quarter, Tennessee leading. Built in 1870, this is the oldest building on the Syracuse campus, the Hall of Languages, home to the College of Arts and Sciences. And not too far away, the Carrier Dome, jam-packed, sold out for weeks. Tennessee leading 7-0 early in the second quarter. John Johnson helped off during the timeout, and now Wilson is back at middlebacker for the Vols. On a 2nd and 7. And McNabb with the option pitch for McIntosh. Up the left alley to the 14 and another Orangeman first down.
Another superb call by the offensive staff, Coach Kevin Rogers, anticipating the blitz.
Get an update on the TCU Horned Frogs from Larry Beal.
All right, Dave. Dennis Franchione's debut as the head coach of TCU. Isn't that special on special teams? Russell Gary blocks the kick. Greg Walls with the touchdown. 7-0 TCU first quarter. Dave.
Dennis inheriting a one-win program from last year. Moving over from New Mexico. First down, up the middle. Dragging the pile to the 10-yard line was Kyle McIntosh on the type of play you normally associate with Rob Conrad, who's got him by about 60 pounds or so. A little 182-pounder squeezes through for a couple. Rob Conrad, in the eighth game last year, tore a tendon in his left knee, and he admitted afterwards that he was injured because he was never in shape. He got a little bit lazy with his form. He ran too upright, and it cost him. And he has one last chance, Bill, his senior year, to stay healthy and finally fulfill that promise. McNabb throwing back, uncovered in the end zone of Stephen Brominski. Could you design it or execute it any better than that?
Superb play calling and execution for the entire drive, the length of the field. My hat's off to Coach Kevin Rogers and the execution of Dexter McNabb and the rest of this offensive unit that has recovered quite nicely from the early mistakes.
Nate Trout ties it with the extra point. None of the tight ends on the Syracuse roster had any catches in their careers coming into this one. Well, Stephen Brominski has one, and he'll remember it. The Orangemen pull even in the second quarter. Seven all. Stephen Brominski, kind of the utility man last year. One of the seven new starters on the offense for the Orangemen, and being lonely never felt so good.
He was all by his lonesome over there. It was a perfectly executed sprint and throwback. That is not nearly as easy as it looks, and the Tennessee defense, I'm sure, has been drilled on that. But they are fast pursuing, and it was designed for just that.
New man for the ball, Cedric Wilson this time. And right up the middle of the 30. How exactly did he get so all alone?
Okay, you'll see Brominski, who's lined up here. And he'll block down, and then he'll drift out here to the corner. And either the strong safety, the outside linebacker, or the free safety were responsible for covering him. But they simply didn't pay attention. Well executed, great football play. Junior tight end Stephen Brominski.
New faces in the backfield behind Martin, Will Bartholomew, Travis Henry. Maybe 3 yards for Henry, who is a sophomore out of Frostproof, Florida, brought down by Phil Nash. Henry, a member of the state championship team in Florida as a senior, in the playoffs alone, gained over 1,000 yards and came away with 7 Florida state rushing records, 14 games in a row of 200 or more yards. He's behind Lewis. This carry by Bartholomew, redshirt freshman, to the 35. Well, still to come on college football's first official weekend. Great doubleheader at 7 Eastern, 4 Pacific. Our primetime crew is in Birmingham for BYU, Alabama. Mike Dubose trying to improve on his 4-7 from a year ago. And at 10 Eastern, 7 Pacific, 16th-ranked Colorado State. Colorado sold out Mile High Stadium, the biggest battle ever in college football, intrastate version, at least, in that state. So on 3rd and 5, 4 wideouts. Pass almost intercepted point blank by Jason Poles.
And this Syracuse defense is playing with more abandon, but they're also lining up. George DeLeon has got them in a cock defense that they have not shown before. Now, in the pass situation here, they're lined up in three men up front. The strong safety's coming off the corner. He jumps. Poles makes an excellent athletic move to bat the ball. Tennessee has not seen that front in any of the Syracuse film.
Well, they came after Leverton, and they got a piece. Really nice break for Tennessee on the roll, though, to the 42. Maurice Jackson with a block of the punt by Leverton. It goes only 22 yards. The Syracuse defense and special teams rising up to match the level set by their offense. There have been a few special team snafus for Syracuse, but this time they come up big with the block punt.
They are redeeming themselves. Maurice Jackson, the theory of this punt protection is that he can't come from that spot outside and get a piece of this ball. But the outside man doesn't get enough of him to deter him and get him off course. And what Maurice did that was very wise, he didn't go at the punter. He went at the point where the ball would leave the punter's foot, which is roughly 8.5 yards behind the line of scrimmage, and he got a piece of it. So Syracuse is finally starting out with some good field position. First time, really.
10-2 speed out there on the corner for Jackson. They don't count on him being quite that fast to get to the punt. Three straight three and outs by Tennessee's offense. Option pitch for Johnson, who is run down by Fred White, the strong safety. Check in again in the studio with Larry Beal.
All right, Dave, we're all psyched about the first big weekend of college football, but the Big Mac attack is about to be unleashed. Mark McGwire, 59 homers. Sammy Sosa with 57. As soon as McGwire comes up to the plate, we'll show it to you today, interspersed with our football coverage. If McGwire doesn't go deep today, he's got 59. We'll have the Cards, Reds tomorrow on ESPN2 at 2. And then Monday, guaranteed Cubs, Cards, 2 p.m. Eastern, Labor Day right here.
Second down 14 after the loss of the option. And McNabb's going to lose more. Back to the 28 on the sack. Corey Terry coming up from defensive end, a returning starter who had 4 sacks as a junior a year ago.
The people ask me a lot, well, what's a defensive end doing with a number like 22? Well, so many times you recruit great backs that are big and fast. You get them in the weight room, you feed them well, and before you know it, they're big enough to beat defensive linemen, and that's what happened with Corey. So he kept his number, and it's awful hard for a 300-pounder pass protector, an athlete with that kind of ability.
And obviously, he didn't lose all his speed as he gained all that weight.
Oh, no.
Second sack by the Vols. And that brings third and 23. McNabb pulling up on the run. Dangerous pass, but he threads it to Johnson. And they're going to mark him with a first down. When you wonder why people mention McNabb and Heisman in the same sentence, well, here's why.
And Donovan actually breaks one of the cardinal rules of football by throwing back across his body. Kevin Johnson, number 12, keeps working to get himself open. But when you throw back across your body, you really don't get enough of the football. And it almost results in an interception. Kevin Johnson's concentration made that a good play, along with Donovan McNabb's sensational ability.
Sensational numbers. Midway second quarter, he still has only one incompletion. Breaking some tackles is Conrad down to the 31. 15 yards. And he's wearing that number 44 the way they expected him to when they gave it to him 3 years ago.
Watch the balance of Rob Conrad here. He clears the line of scrimmage. He's looking for somebody to run over. Good job up front on the trap blocking to spring him into the secondary.
Timeout, 6:01 to play, 7-all in the first half in Syracuse. Phil Fulmer looked a lot happier when his line was dominating in the first quarter, and right now they are being dominated, and they've been tied.
Yeah, we really focused on one of the themes in this game, the ability of the defenses to hold up, these two young defenses. And right now, Syracuse has turned the momentum in this situation.
Donovan McNabb, near perfect through the air so far. 11 out of 12 for 115 and a touchdown. McIntosh trying to find an alley to squeeze through. A whole lot more powerful than you figure he is when you look at him at 5'8", 182. He moves the pile forward.
Not only did he move the pile forward, but number 67, Bill O'Donnell, who's been around here a long time, the starting right guard, pulls, leads up in here, and provides the extra impetus to get this ball, boom, right there with Al Wilson. Al Wilson is up in the air, ends up back behind the pile, which is not the place that Al wants to be. Good job by number 67, Bill O'Donnell, to spring his back.
McIntosh again, no such luck this time. A heat-seeking missile where number 27, Al Wilson, sliding over. Tennessee referred to in a pregame press conference by Paul Pasqualoni five times in one sentence, I counted it, and seven times in one paragraph as either fast or speedy or some combination.
That's right, and when you talk to his assistant coaches, they all sound just like Paul. Fast, speedy, quick. Al Wilson didn't like getting blocked by Bill O'Donnell, and he played a little payback on that last play.
They say man for man, they're about as fast as the fastest of the Miami teams that they face every year in the Big East. They're much faster. Option keeper, flag is down as Donovan McNabb neared first down territory at the 20.
Let's see what the flag is. Brilliant strategy by good option quarterbacks is to fake the pitch and take it up inside, which is what Donovan did on that play.
This officiating crew headed by Steve Shaw, the referee right there, all SEC officials.
Holding on the offense, 10-yard penalty from the spot of the pass, the third down.
Very serious transgression by the Syracuse offense, probably from where the flag was thrown, somebody out in the tight end range. Paul Pasqualoni reflects the way it feels for the head coach. Now instead of third and two, for a nice little option quarterback keep will get you the first down. It's third and 11, an entirely different matter. A lot of good calls, Dave, on third and two. Everybody looks at each other on third and 11 and say, what's he got? What's your best call here?
That's where coaching staffs become suddenly democratic.
Yes, they get
everybody
quiet.
Gets
they get
quiet. Well, on third and 11, what do they have? They roll McNabb. Pulls up and a little bit on the throw intended for Quentin Spotwood. He was pretty well covered as it was by Dwayne Goodrich. And it will be fourth and 11.
Yeah, Dwayne Goodrich had a fairly good coverage. Spotwood explodes off the line like good receivers do. He's number eight. But he should catch this football. He's supposed to be the best hands in the history of the program. He tries to catch it with his forearm. If he turns his fingers and his thumbs are together and he looks that ball in, Spotwood makes that catch so that this field goal attempt would be much closer.
It is 49 yards by Nate Trout. It would be the longest of his career. Out of the hold of Kevin Johnson. Mike Bennett's snap is good. Got enough leg, but he's wide left.
The ball was positioned in the best hash mark location for a right-footed kicker. On that left hash, that's a good spot. Right-footed kickers like that. He had plenty of distance. He just didn't get the job done. Yet another mistake in the kicking game that keeps Syracuse from getting more points on the board.
Tennessee back on the offensive. 3:49 to go. And Martin looking deep off the play fake. but overthrows Peerless Price, who was single covered by Ian McIntosh. And as we get close to halftime, the National Car Rental Halftime Report with Larry Beal. Let's join Larry for an update.
All right, Dave, naturally at the half, the National Car Rental Report. We'll have highlights, highlights, and more highlights from the Big Ten. The SEC will also check in with the Game Day Gang in South Bend. Let's go back to the Dome.
Lewis with a little stop and start for about three. Syracuse in time of possession, and Bill, a lot of times this is the most overrated stat in football, but not necessarily today. They have about a 3-1 advantage over Phil Fulmer's offense in time of possession.
Don't tell those defensive linemen it's overrated. It keeps them off the field.
And this is what he feared. He was afraid that the ball control of Syracuse might eliminate the chances for his big play guys to go out there and show what they could do. And so far, his fears have been very well founded. Martin this time with a strike, and reaching forward is Price to the 48. It'll be a first down under 3 minutes.
Well executed football play here. Just a curl by Peerless Price and a perfect throw by the young quarterback T. Martin. The junior quarterback set up perfectly, stepped forward, finished his throw, disregarding the pressure, never considered the fact that he was going to be hit. Nice completion, first down.
T. Martin, 3 out of 8, 56 yards in his first half. Incomplete double coverage that time. Intended for Price, Nash, and McIntosh there to gang up on.
That's right, and Martin followed up his excellent play with a mistake. He threw into double coverage and perhaps pulled the string at the end to sort of throw it away rather than, once he realized, throw it where he was intending to throw it, which would have been an interception.
Tennessee began this game as if they would name their score. They moved it at will in the first quarter. Hardly at all since then. Another stop-and-go drive forward by Lewis, who reaches Syracuse territory. Keith Bullock from middle linebacker on the tackle. Let's check in with Dave Ryan.
Well, Dave and Bill, in our meetings with defensive coordinator George DeLeon yesterday with Syracuse, he wondered, as did we, who would be the players for the Syracuse defense to step up because this unit is so inexperienced, losing 7-11 starters. It's been Keith Bullock and Jason Poles, without question, the captain and the inside linebacker, really stepping it up, guys.
And got the crowd up behind him as well. They third and four, under 2 minutes, hanging it up deep, too deep. Not easy to overthrow Peerless Price, but Martin did.
A well-designed defense by Coach DeLeon, a two-deep coverage, meaning double zone, with the corner getting a chuck or a bump on the outside receiver, the safety coming off the hash. Had he thrown the ball inbounds, it would have been batted away by the safety.
Everton has a pretty good chance of hitting the Orangemen pretty deep. Ricky Simpkins, defensive tackle, limping his left knee after that last play, but he stays in. Waving for the fair catch, vacating the premises, Spotwood. He hoped it would go in for a touchback, and it's downed instead at the 7-yard line.
Now, what Spotwood does when he signals a fair catch illegally, as he did there, he tells everybody, I'm not really going to catch this ball.
Coming up, the National Car Rental Halftime Report. Larry Beal, among other topics, highlights from around the Big Ten, the SEC. And he will hear again from the game day crew, Chris Kirk and Lee from Notre Dame, Michigan, in South Bend. Put down by Dominique Stevenson for Tennessee at the 7-yard line with a minute 44 to go. Syracuse has only one timeout. They had to spend two real early in the first quarter. So we'll see how conservative they plan to be here late in the first half. Conrad coughed it up. Was he down? No, he wasn't. Tennessee has it at the 14-yard line. Fred White, the strong safety, as the Orangemen, led by Conrad, argue that he had to have been down.
Number 34, Steve Johnson, the corner who's been playing well in his first start. Steve kind of likes that. He knocked that ball loose from the big fullback, Conrad. The play is well blocked. Scott Kiernan with a good block here. Conrad shedding tacklers, fighting for extra yardage, and that's when you have to rivet that ball to your rib cages. Johnson's able to get it out right here.
Is he down, though? Knees down, ball's loose.
The officials were right there on the spot. They make the call.
Looked like Conrad might have had an argument. Martin on the roll and overthrown in the corner of the end zone. Jermaine Copeland wide open.
That is nothing but adrenaline. T would love to throw that again. He's in his first game. He's got a lot of enthusiasm. He's got his guy wide open, and he just puts a little too much on it. He'll complete a million of those in the next 2 years.
Well, last year he threw only 465 fewer passes than Peyton Manning. So reps. He needs reps. 6 of 12 last year. 3 of 11 in this first half. Knocked away from Price by Nash, and Price never knew what hit him.
Well, he knows now that Phil Nash understands how to play safety. He moved from corner, and he wasn't real excited about it at first, but he understands now that he has a lead position in this secondary. Peerless Price all the way across the field, expecting to make this catch and go in the end zone, but he is interrupted most rudely by Mr. Nash, number 10.
Phil Nash moved very reluctantly from cornerback. Said, why do you want to move me over? They said, you have the best range in the secondary, as he just showed. They come with a max blitz chasing Martin, who will be dragged down shy of the first at the 8-yard line by Keith Bullock. That is one fast middle backer.
That is an incredible play by a middle linebacker to run that quarterback down and get him on the ground. And that's one reason in today's football, so many former defensive backs and running backs are moved to those positions up front. We've got a flag on the play.
He just ran down a guy at 4-5.
Well, he's got some of that 4-5 himself.
This marker was thrown right about the point where the tackle was made.
When they talk this long, you always get nervous about whether they really know what happened on the play. Somebody needs to make a decision here. This is not good.
Well, they're letting everybody weigh in.
Yeah, the officials have an obligation to make a reasonable point decision.
We have holding on a defense. We have a dead ball, personal foul on a defense. It's going to be first and goal.
Wow.
You heard it from the horse's mouth. Dead ball, personal foul would have taken it to half the distance, and so would the other holding call, defensive holding. Here's Bullock. Here's the man who made the play. This is not easy when you're a middle linebacker. He's coming inside out with a poor pursuit angle. He dives. Superb play. We never did see where the penalties might have been called, but they were certainly called.
So from the two, Bryson, the fullback, and he gets inside the one and then turned away as we near the 1-minute mark. Tennessee has 2 timeouts remaining.
And that's a big play by the Syracuse defense because they didn't let them just walk in the end zone. They got those pads down. They played good goal line defense. They knocked the O-line back, and Keith Bullock met the back in the hole to prevent the touchdown.
John Bryson Fulmer feels the best fullback in the SEC. A former tailback who still runs as if he thinks he's a tailback. Around a 4-4-40. Timeout called by the Vols. They have one left. A little bit less than 1 minute left in the first half. Tennessee given a huge break by the double penalties against Syracuse, keeping this drive going. They now look at second down and goal. A lot of things they can do here with the ability to run, throw on the run, or option that T. Martin brings to the table. 3 different ways they can use him down here.
Normally in this time of year, the coaches want to make a statement to the other teams, not just to Syracuse, but to everybody that plays Tennessee. We will knock you into the end zone and take it in. It gets a little more complicated when you consider the fact that there's only one timeout left and 57 seconds. But my guess is that that's what they'll do, especially with a young quarterback, not putting the pressure on him to throw the ball from the 6-inch line.
Will Bartholomew is the fullback in front of Lewis. Going to be Martin keeping. Touchdown. And Tennessee leads for the second time today on the one-yard keeper by T. Martin, thanks to the penalties against Syracuse, which kept their drive alive.
There is a right way and a wrong way to run a quarterback sneak. Watch the line come off the ball. Root hog or die, that's the old adage. The Tennessee line comes off, knocks them back. T runs the quarterback sneak properly by getting his pads down, not getting up in the air. Touchdown.
That falls PAT 14-7 with 53 seconds remaining first half. Today's featured matchup on ABC's College Football, 3:30 Eastern. Number 21 Southern Miss traveling to State College, and they take on number 13 Penn State. Joe Paterno going for win number 299 in his career. Check your local listings for the game in your area.
Yep.
Bob Conrad and the Orangemen offense dominating most of the second quarter, and how disappointed they have to be to look up there and see they're right where they were at the end of the first, still down by seven, even though if you track the momentum in this game, it's been all on their side from really middle of the first quarter on. Well, let's get an update on Mark McGuire this afternoon from Larry Beal.
Well, we told you we'd be chasing history and following the chase. Here it comes. There it goes. Mark McGuire, first at bat of the game off of Dennis Reyes as the Reds face the Cards. That is number 60. Big Mac has just tied Babe Ruth, 2-0 Cards.
You know, anytime you see one barely go out, you figure to him that's a pop-up. He didn't get all that.
Yeah, that's the one where you and I used to pop it up and the shortstop caught it.
It doesn't hit upper deck. I don't think he feels it was a true swing. Well, number 60 and counting for Mark McGuire will continue to be updated as he goes after the record tying shot. Dave Ryan, what was the story on those Syracuse penalties a moment ago?
Well, Dave just asked one of the officials, the field judge, a moment ago about that exact play on T. Martin when he rolled right there and was hit. They said late hit. That was the personal foul call. They couldn't give me a number as to who was involved, but late hit was a problem against Syracuse, giving Tennessee the great chance to score.
Did not see a late hit.
I did not see a late hit, but I just saw a bad kick, which gives Syracuse field position with a chance to do something. With this quarterback and these receivers in 53 seconds, something could happen here for Syracuse. One timeout on the clock.
They have Spotwood right, Johnson Daniel left, McNabb in the shotgun. Daniel, four about five, maybe six. Double coverage. Remember, Syracuse, one timeout, and the clock rolls at 43 seconds.
Too deep. Simple zone. That's the kind of throw that Tennessee would like for Donovan to make. He's going to have to go a little deeper to get anything done here.
This is Conrad. Got a block. Heads for the middle. Right at midfield. It's a first down. And they'll move the chains with 21 seconds.
The most dropped ball in football passing is the screen. Conrad handles the screens extremely well. Makes the most of his blocking.
And you got to figure there at least 20 yards away from field goal range. One, maybe two more pops. This is a catch by Johnson, who gets out of bounds. Although it looked for a minute like he had other ideas. He's to the 44 with 10 seconds.
Yeah, very small thing, but a veteran receiver should take that directly out of bounds rather than wasting 2 or 3 seconds dancing. He wasn't going to make much more yardage. He could see that immediately. Kevin knows what he's doing, but they need to get it on down 10 or 12 more yards to give Trout a chance.
Well, over the middle, caught by Johnson. 3 seconds. Stop the clock with 1 second to go at the 21-yard line. A 23-yard catch and run by Kevin Johnson. Last timeout will be called here by Syracuse as they get Trout on the field.
The whole story here is that Donovan McNabb has far too much time to throw. Kevin Johnson has taken his own sweet time getting across the secondary, and in zone coverage with a veteran quarterback, he will nail you every time if the protection holds up. Good job of the offensive line. Good job of catching in the hands by Kevin Johnson, giving his team a shot at a field goal. Real good execution by this Syracuse veteran offense.
Now the first try from Trout would have been a career best 49 yarder, and it was just wide. It had enough leg. This will be right at 39 yards. Johnson is his holder.
Yeah, the distance was not the problem. He probably just got his plant foot twisted a little bit to the left as he pulled the ball, which is unusual kicking from this hash. He should actually line this up and get his plant foot down pointing at the right upright, because right-footed kickers tend to hook the ball slightly, so that should bring it right back to the middle if he'll just do what I said he should do.
If they just listen. Rob last year missed only 11 out of 15. This will actually be 38 yards to end the first half. And this time he is good. So the Orangemen salvage 3, squeezing every second off that first half clock. As they head to the locker room, little momentum despite a 4-point deficit. T. Martin, 3 of 12 in his debut. McNabb near perfect, 15 of 17, but his Orangemen trail 14 to 10 as we send it to the studio and Larry Beer. We are just about set for the second half at the Carrier Dome. 14-10 lead for Tennessee over the Orangemen of Syracuse. And in the first half, the quarterbacks, as we expected, told a great deal of the story, but not all the story. Donovan McNabb was near perfect, Bill. 15 of 17 through the air, but they got only 10 points. And T. Martin, on their first series, looked like he would be even better than Peyton Manning. His first completion, 33 yards. Second one, 12 yards, and the touchdown. He has only one completion since those two.
That's right. He has, I believe, tensed up just a little bit, which is understandable. His team is in the lead. What the coaches are trying to do is give him plays that he's comfortable with. They have the lead now, regardless of his performance in the first half and what he does in the second half. They just want to escape with the win, get their young quarterback untracked so that he's ready for the rest of the season. But he will have to be more accurate, Dave, in the second half for them to have a chance to win. The other thing that's happening is the Syracuse defense has come up with a scheme that Tennessee hasn't been able to block since the first series. When they went rumbling down the field, George DeLeon dipped into his bag of tricks and came up with a cocked nose scheme that has given Tennessee all kinds of fits in the running game.
Nate Trout, who ended the first half with a field goal to get the Orangemen within 4, will kick to Cedric Wilson. And drives Wilson back to his goal line. Well, they are all track level speedsters at those wideouts and kick return spots for the balls. 23-yard return here. Let's go back to Larry Beal.
All right, Dave, chasing history. Mark McGwire homered in his first at bat. Here is his second at bat against Dennis Reyes. Big swing and a miss. So Big Mac stuck on 60. We continue to keep you updated as the day goes along. Dave?
Well, the real question continues to be, how far above 70 is he going to wind up?
Well, he's got to get to 61 first. It gets a little tougher here, I think, in the big leagues.
Out of the eye, Martin will keep on the option for maybe 2. And lost his hat in the process. Welcome to starting quarterback. Let's go down to Dave Ryan.
Well, guys, a few minutes ago, I talked with Tennessee head coach Philip Fermler. He's very, very concerned with his team's inability to really get a good job in lassoing Donovan McNabb. I know a lot of coaches feel the same way, but especially on third and 15 plays, they had a good rap on McNabb and couldn't put him down. One thing to watch for Tennessee, Al Wilson, star linebacker, and T. Martin, their quarterback, both left the first half early with cramps. They got IVs, rehydrated at halftime. We'll see how that affects them the second half, guys.
That's pretty cool outside, not in here, not where it's not air conditioned. The run stuffers for Syracuse show up. Bullock, who had a big first half. He has set the defensive tone from the middle of the first quarter on, and he's a big reason that Phil Fulmer has had that worried look on his face from about the first quarter on.
Yes, indeed, he has played well, but it is the scheme that's giving the Tennessee linemen fits. They have a cocked nose and an offset defensive tackle, blitzing the little middle linebacker and dropping him in combination coverage, and it is extremely difficult for this Tennessee offense to handle.
Little fumble Ruski here, and rumbling for the first down for Tennessee is Spencer Riley, the center. But there are markers down if this play stands at 17 yards. It was so loud when Martin was calling the signals, you figured, how can he be hurt? Maybe he didn't have to be.
Dead ball foul. That's an illegal snap on the offense. 5 yards.
All right, it's an old play. What did they do wrong?
What they did wrong was they didn't remember that the play has been outlawed. The old rule said that you could snap the ball, put it on the ground, a lineman could pick it up and run with it. Now, they didn't do it intentionally here. The big fellow lost his head. He cannot advance that ball. It is now judged by the officials correctly as an illegal snap.
So they worked all summer long on that. For nothing.
No, I think it was an accident. I really think the ball, I think the quarterback pulled out. They didn't intend that to happen. That's what I think.
I think he's going to have a real hard time being heard now. They're coming after him. Martin chased by the blitz, let that one fly in desperation.
Here comes everybody from Syracuse. They are playing with such spirit. This is an odd front that we showed you earlier. Safety blitzes, corner blitzes, linebacker blitzes, all unfettered right into the quarterback's face, making it impossible for T. Martin to set up and make his throw.
Timeout Syracuse. Well, this is what cost them early in the first quarter. They burned two in the first 4 minutes of the first quarter. And they call one here.
On the defense, that's a timeout.
That is another equipment problem for Paul Castelloni to check into. One too many. Second time Syracuse is charged with a timeout for an equipment violation. SEC officiating staff sticklers on fashion. Spotwood on the return of Leverton's punt. Little hesitation, now picks his way with a marker down inside the 40. Two markers are down in fact. And while they sort it out, let's check with Dave Ryan.
Well, Dave, you mentioned the penalty a moment ago on Ian McIntosh. He's just heading off the field now to get his knee pads fixed. The second guilty party for Syracuse. A moment ago, head coach Paul Pasqualoni came over to the equipment manager, Kyle Federley, and screamed at him, Kyle, let's get this straightened out. That's twice in the game today. We cannot allow it to happen again. Dave and Bill at halftime, he told his team, mistakes breed mistakes. We can't do this against a great team like Tennessee.
Well, another mistake here. They could call for an illegal block. And this will move their drive start back to the 41.
Again and again, mistakes in the kicking game from the most unlikely source, this Syracuse team. And there it is, Jason Poles, the defensive captain, hits the guy right in the back. Now, coaches train players for weeks and years to do nothing but pull off in a situation like that.
Donovan McNabb, first give, Kyle McIntosh, maybe one. In all the years you coached in the SEC, were the officials that much of a stickler for the letter of the law as far as how you wear your uniform. We've seen it called twice here.
Dave, they're sticklers not for fashion purposes, but for safety purposes. Wide receivers and DBs love to roll up their pants so their knees are exposed. But the officials in the SEC are instructed to not let that happen. Bobby Gaston is the head of officiating, and they will not let you run around in what they call Bermuda shorts and play this game. And they are right to do that.
McNabb nowhere to go. As they bring everybody in a white shirt, first to get there, Jeff Coleman and Corey Terry. And for an Iowa Central Michigan update, let's hear from Larry Beal.
Well, how about Iowa State and TCU? Will you take that one? Todd Bandauer hitting Andy Stenstrud. Nice fade pattern and the catch. And they are tied at 7 at the half. Back to the Carrier Dome.
Well, how about Iowa State and TCU? They had a good one.
They are having a good one. We're having a good one here. Two very interesting defensive strategies in running situations by the two defensive coordinators.
Now we get to the 48 of the balls, and McNabb chased again. Spent a lot of time running for his life today. Throwback Conrad almost breaks it. He has plenty for the first down, though, to the 39. 23 yards. The escape ability of Donovan McNabb and his ability to throw on the run, just marvelous. We've seen it 2 or 3 times today.
What the Tennessee line is doing in running situations is they line up like you just saw them there in the passing situation. After Donovan McNabb calls the audible, then they move. It's called stemming. In this case, they didn't do it. McNabb escapes contain, gets the ball again across his body, but he's successful to Conrad. But the strategy of moving the defensive line after the quarterback makes the audible call, especially in first and 10 situations, is hampering the Syracuse running game. Two Tennessee players down and injured right now.
That is Jeff Coleman, 92, defensive tackle from Gaffney, South Carolina. Eric Westmoreland with apparently a cramp problem, strong side linebacker from Jasper, Tennessee. And they're also working on Fred White. It's awfully warm for a place named the Carrier Dome, but if you've ever been here, you're aware that this is not an air-conditioned facility. And with 50,000 people in here, it gets a little bit steamy.
How could we be in the Carrier Dome?
I don't know.
And not have air conditioning? Wouldn't they want to use this as a great symbol of their air conditioning prowess or something?
You would think. It's just not that hot that often here, but it's warm today. So the best thing to do is kind of crack those windows and try and get a little air circulating.
I'm not sure that's the best ventilation system I've ever seen for comfort. Now, I'm sure it's safe from the public standpoint, or the fire marshal and others wouldn't allow it. But now, these guys are used to warm weather. Both these teams have worked hard. They should not be cramping up just because of a little humidity.
Coleman helped off. McNabb option pitch. McIntosh, and they finally have some room. Conrad with a lead block out there. They will mark him out about short of the marker and just short of the 30, where Al Wilson chased him down and finished him off.
The option play is so named because the quarterback has the privilege of making a decision. He has the option to keep the ball or pitch the ball. The offense is designed to seal everyone inside except the outside man. Donovan does a great job here of bringing it to the outside and pitching it at just the right time to his back, McIntosh, who gains 9 yards.
Option football becomes fashionable again around the country. It was never out of fashion here at Syracuse. McIntosh rooms straight up the gut for the first to the 22.
And we've seen about 10 different formations from Syracuse today. They have 7 systems. They have 32 formations. This is just a straight isolation play. Good blocking. The lineman coming off there. The tight end, O'Donnell, pulling around. Good running by little McIntosh, who runs with power and authority for someone his size.
But he came to Syracuse for games just like this one and the next one, where they visit Michigan. Rob Conrad. How is it that in this era of limited practice time, limited rosters, Syracuse can have almost unlimited variations to their offense and execute them all so well.
Well, as you know, Dave, we asked Paul Pasqualoni that question, and he said with the 17-hour rule, it's not really a 20-hour rule because you have to use 3 hours to play the game. So with the 17-hour rule, we can't, our coaching staff has to use every single minute in the meetings and every single minute in practices, but we are committed to teaching this multiple system, and as you can see, they've done it.
McNabb, he's gonna keep, take the pitch, turn it up. McNabb at the five, and it's first and goal.
Brilliant option football. Watch the veteran quarterback with Rob Conrad out leading. Watch him. Beautiful, just like the fast break in his beloved round ball. He fakes it and takes it to the hook. If it had been basketball, he would have slam dunked, which is how he scored his first basket against Pittsburgh as a basketball player for Syracuse University.
Out of a hand bone. Three big backs behind McNabb. And they were laying in wait for Conrad. Raynock Thompson says, not this time.
The one thing you cannot allow in wishbone football is penetration. Syracuse is lined up in wishbone football. Raynock Thompson is going to penetrate, get in the backfield, and nail Conrad before he can get untracked. There it is. There's a blocker who's assigned to that gap who did not get the job done. The offender was Stephen Bominski, who knew he didn't get down inside far enough to block Thompson and keep him out of the backfield.
Bominski, the tight end who has the touchdown today. Touchdown catch, his first ever for the Orangemen. Now Conrad in motion to break the bone. On the roll, McNabb, ball tipped up, incomplete. Intended for Darryl Stroop, the second tight end. Billy Ratliff coming strong from defensive tackle.
Ratliff's a guy that they were counting on to be a starter who's been injured, and he's only going to be allowed to play 20 or 25 plays today, but he certainly got his hand up at an appropriate time for his defensive mates that time.
For his right ACL last November, a game against Southern Miss. Made it back for the opener this year. Third and goal, Spotwood and Johnson, both right side, and now some indecision. They're supposed to be on the other side, and that will cost the Orangemen another timeout. Or they are ironing out the early season wrinkles. One more timeout, we're midway third quarter. Seventh year head coach Phil Fulmer defending SEC champion Tennessee, hanging by a thread right now. 4-point lead over Syracuse with 8:41 to go in the third quarter. And Paul Pasqualoni in his eighth year, little bit hot, as you would expect, having to use another timeout because of confusion out of the huddle. Now they're ready to go on third and goal from the five. Defending Big East champs. Trying to open with a big national statement. McNabb, one-handed grab, but Conrad can only manage about the two. Boy, it took all his concentration just to make the catch, and when he turned around, Goodrich was all over him. So fourth and goal, and for Pasqualoni, he will settle apparently for the three.
One of the most important principles in screen operation is for the linemen to hold up the rushers just a split second before they leave. The Syracuse linemen left too early. McNabb was forced to throw too early. Conrad was a sitting duck out there.
So Trout will try to get him within one. 20-yarder. End of the first half, he hit from 38. And he hits this one. So 14-13 still has to be more than a little disappointing for the Orangemen to have to settle for three. For 37 years, baseball's most glorified record has withstood the test of time. Monday, Mark McGwire and Sammy Sosa continue the chase for history. It's the Cubs at the Cardinals Labor Day afternoon, Monday, 2 Eastern, 11 Pacific. If you've made Labor Day plans, change them immediately. You have an appointment in front of you, too, as Sosa and McGuire continue their chase. Mark McGuire has hit number 60 today at Busch Stadium.
If you're a football player or a coach, Labor Day means just that. It doesn't mean holiday. My last Labor Day off, in case anybody cares, was 1954. We report for work. But maybe I'll find a way to watch that.
Well, that might even be a little bit out of Mark's range. Let's check in with Dave Ryan.
Well, Dave and Bill, the Tennessee defensive players are dropping like flies due to cramps. Jeff Coleman, the starting left defensive tackle, is out with a mild right ankle sprain and cramps. Eric Westmoreland just left the field to get hydrated because of cramps. And this is starting quarterback Steve Johnson. He's got cramp problems. They're icing the players' calves, dumping water over their heads, and giving them ice towels in the sideline on both sides. But, guys, it's especially affecting the Tennessee Volunteers today. It's hot down here.
It's hot in Knoxville, too, but it's not indoors. And there is something strange about playing in a dome if you're not accustomed to it. And it does affect your mindset and hence probably your body chemistry. So these guys are experiencing cramps. This temperature is not nearly as hot as what they've worked in Knoxville, but it is different. The air does not move. I had the same experience in the Astrodome as a player.
Situation for Tennessee. Will start to get a little bit worrisome. On the return, Cedric Wilson to the 28-yard line, and let's check in with Larry Beal in the studio.
Thanks, Dave. Air Force and Wake Forest, and Wake getting the wake-up call. On the option, the pitch to Polario Brown. Oh, look at the move! And he's gone. 73 yards, 21-0 Air Force. Let's go back to the Carrier Dome.
So Wake Forest in some top 25 preseason rankings this year.
They've got a good football team. They've run into a buzzsaw out there with the Air Force.
Able to squeeze for much more than 2 yards that time was Jamal Lewis. Bullock on the tackle, and T. Martin, since his promising start, has really been bottled up, and so has Lewis.
This is the defense that has made the difference. Look at the cock nose man. He can do a variety of things with these linemen stunting, and it has completely destroyed the continuity of Tennessee's blocking combinations. Something that the coaches at Syracuse pulled out of their hat, and it's working very effectively in run situations. Here it is again.
Fake the draw. Martin going deep up the side, and it is caught. It was underthrown, but what an adjustment by Peerless Price for 33 yards.
And a beautiful blitz pickup by Jamal Lewis, number 31, the great running tailback. Last year they said Jamal couldn't block. This year he has learned to do his job. One of the things that the tailback, number 31, must learn to do is to pick up the safety when he comes late. You can't do it much better than that. Jason Poles, I think, was a little surprised to see him. Here's the top defense once again, popularized by George Perlis and the Steelers back in the 70s.
Martin, one of his previous 10 before that one. That was mostly Price. This is Price again to the 30. Peerless Price, by far his favorite receiver today. Copeland has just one catch. It was for 33. That's 4 for 62 now for Peerless Price.
And it's been a long time between good throws, even excellent throws, by T. Martin. But he's coming back and showing his poise. He's shaking off the early jitters, and he's looking like the skilled quarterback that he is.
5 out of 15, 95 yards. And the touchdown. Up the middle, quick breaker for the fullback, Sean Bryson, who is at the 10.
Okay, when you get that cocked front with all kinds of stunts, there's a risk involved for the defense. The best thing to do is to hand it to your fullback straight ahead, the lineman coming off hard, blocking whatever the defensive lineman give you, and this time it works to perfection. It's a hit or miss, feast or famine type defense. And Tennessee has figured out what to do. If they keep handing to the fullback, they're going to gash it again.
Now, is that going to keep them from doing that for the next two or three plays?
No, I don't think so. I think we'll still see it. There it is.
Martin, option left. Balls toward the goal line. He almost made it. They will put him down at the one. And from that point, Tennessee in great shape, trying to add to a one-point lead late third quarter.
This is a quarterback keeper. Tennessee has devised a strategy for this Cock defense now. They all scoop toward the Cock defense. The quarterback has no intention of pitching this ball. He needs to put it away a little sooner, but they end up very close to touchdown territory.
Will Bartholomew, the fullback, in the eye. Lewis with a leap is in. Touchdown.
One of the things the Syracuse coaches said repeatedly is when our crowd is in the game, when things are going well, they are a tremendous advantage. But if the other team ever starts to get the edge, they tend to get quiet. And I think it's going to be very interesting to see what happens after this play as Tennessee gets right back into the lead or extends its lead. That ball has to break the plane of the goal line, and it did with that mighty leap.
The veteran Jeff Hall with the 144th PAT of his career. The senior from Winchester, Tennessee, has a backup eight. Under 5.5, third quarter. Paul Pasqualoni has never lost to an SEC team. Now, that sounds pretty impressive. He's only played two of them, and not for 7 years. Vanderbilt and Florida both losing to Syracuse back in 91, both by wide margins.
They played a great game in this dome against Florida, and that was a great Florida team that they beat.
91 against anybody from the SEC, and they've had, as expected, their hands more than full, trailing 21-13. McIntosh with the touchback. Up to the Orangemen now to try and pump life back into this sellout. Whatever they have given the crowd anything at all to be happy about, it's been deafening in here, but Jamal Lewis just silenced them for at least a few minutes, capping off that six-play drive.
That was significant for a lot of reasons. They scored a touchdown, whereas Syracuse had to settle for the field goal. They rested their defense with a lengthy, time-consuming drive. Very important with all this cramp stuff.
D. Brown is the tailback. He takes the pitch from McMahon. Conrad out in front with a block to the 31-yard line. Should be 11 and a first, and it is.
Whatever has gone before, we now see two superb quarterbacks leading their teams and drive after drive. This is exciting football from the offensive standpoint and very difficult for the defenses. The two defenses have combined various strategies, have done well over long stretches, but they're now both vulnerable.
And that's a good sign for the Vols. Jeff Coleman, who is battling the cramps, is back in. And earlier, Sean Ellis was limping around a little bit, and he's also back in, the defensive lineman on the left side of that front for Tennessee. They fake the reverse. They ran it in the first half, and McNabb can't get the deep ball off. Volunteers say they've hopped on it at the 28-yard line, but no official signal yet. And there it is, Tennessee ball.
Darwin Walker, number 58, the big defensive tackle, a 515-pound bencher, just knocked that ball loose, and it was not a pass. The arm was not going forward. Very often when you try gadget plays, this is a fake reverse. What happens on the gadget plays is you don't get enough work. The protection's not good here. The ball is knocked loose. And yet another turnover.
Guy that jumped on it, who just recovered from his own battle with cramps, was Jeff Coleman, the left tackle.
Yeah, his cramps are feeling a lot better right now.
Volunteers. Over the middle, Martin caught by Copeland. And he pinballs his way to a first and goal inside the 10. 20 yards from Martin. An update from Iowa City, Larry Beal.
All right, Dave, I found my thrill, and his name is Hill. Iowa and Central Michigan, Khalil Hill. He scored on a punt return earlier. This is the second half kickoff, and he is gone. 88 yards for the touchdown, 14-0 for the freshman.
Oh, in the proud tradition of Tim Dwight, an Iowa return game alive and well. Shaken up is Phil Nash, who has been a busy man, free safety for Syracuse, and two fumbles inside their 20 today.
The single most significant statistic in football related to winning is turnovers. To add yet another element to that, to fumble in your own territory is certain death in the game of football. Tennessee's going to try to make Syracuse pay for that right now.
Jamal Lewis with a head of steam and reaches toward the one, at least to the two. In the arms of Charles Burton. Power football, nothing fancy here from Phil Fulmer.
Tennessee has devised a strategy to deal with the Cox defense that had given them so much trouble since the middle of the first quarter. They are wedge blocking. They're just blowing out those lighter defensive linemen, and they're knocking it in the end zone or attempting to knock it in there again.
David Cutcliffe, offensive coordinator. High again. On second and goal, Lewis. And maybe a little past the line of scrimmage. Didn't get the goal line, though. It'll be third and goal. Right at about the one, they unstack it.
They've had success two ways, by handing to the fullback with quick hitters up the middle and by having a lead back offense. That time, they attempted to send the fullback to the right and the tailback to the left, and there was nothing there for Lewis. Syracuse defense needs to rise up right here.
Martin rolling, looking, end zone, deflected. And was it intercepted? No. Incomplete. Boy, that was close. Morlon Greenwood almost got to it.
A surprising call from the Tennessee coaches, Coach David Cutcliffe. This is a full sprint. When you're that close to the goal line and you've been knocking them out of there the way the linemen had been for Tennessee, it might be a better idea just to go up and over inside the 1 yard line.
McNabb watching, more than a little interested. Ball was batted away by Dwight Freeney, forcing Tennessee to settle for the field goal try. 17 yards by Hall. A gimme. But that's also a victory of sorts for the Syracuse defense.
That is a great victory for the Syracuse defense. A superb effort to keep that Tennessee team out of the end zone and keep themselves in this football game. The other side of the coin is it now takes them two scores just to tie the football game. At least an extra point, a two-point extra point with a touchdown and a field goal. I knew I could get that out. I just knew I could.
I'm going to stay with you.
Anyhow, they got to have two scores. That's what I'm trying to say.
Home openers have not been very friendly in the recent history for Syracuse. They've lost four straight. Now, their opener last year was at the Meadowlands against Wisconsin, and they looked like a national championship contender, shutting out Ron Dayne and the Badgers that day. But then at that point, things fell apart, and it took them a while to put them back together. They lost three straight, one-pointer to North Carolina State. They lost by two to Oklahoma, blown out by Virginia Tech 31-3. At that point, Pascalona got it turned around, and they won eight in a row to make the Fiesta and defeated there by Kansas State. They need this one because they're at home. They won't be next week, and they have defending national champion Michigan in the big house.
They get to go to the big house, which is a lot of fun unless you're on the opposing team.
Jeff Hall sends Johnson back to his goal line. Kevin Johnson A touchdown threat anytime he touches it. 29-yard return. Today's featured matchup on ABC at 3:30 Eastern. It is number 21 Southern Miss traveling to State College, and it's number 13 Penn State, and Joe Paterno going for his 299th career win. Check your local listings for the game in your area this afternoon on ABC Sports.
And number 29, Mickey Allen, got a taste of Kevin Johnson's running ability there and probably left a bit of his equipment on the field. He may have to be checked by the equipment. That was a great move by Kevin. Mickey's a good defensive back.
Option pitch for Kyle McIntosh, and Tennessee screens it out the way you're supposed to, where they draw it up.
Exactly, and a mistake by the veteran quarterback. One of the things that the quarterback must do, and Donovan knows this, he's got to threaten that end man on the line of scrimmage to the extent that he takes him out of the play. That time he didn't get close enough to the end man before he pitched the ball, so they got run down for a negative half yard. Real good defense by Tennessee.
Donovan McNabb has only thrown three incompletions today. 17 of 20, 184 yards and a touchdown. And he hasn't had all that much time. Here's another one. Spotwood, a great job hanging on to this one because Andre Lott unloaded on it.
Yes, he did, but we pointed out earlier where Kevin did not use his fingertips to catch the ball. This time he did. And even though he was drilled in the back, the cushioning of his fingers and catching the ball the proper way allowed him to bring it in and keep it.
Syracuse history, only Spotwood and Rob Moore had 1,000 receiving yards by the end of their sophomore seasons.
Kevin's having a tough time catching his breath right now, though. He's a tough guy. He'll be ready to go with his snap.
Well, Blitz is ready to come to McNabb. Throws it out complete, and it is Spotwood for the first down, up to the 47, good for 12.
And Syracuse wisely showing that they have a three-step drop game. One, two, three, set, throw. Rhythm passing is almost impossible to defend. Spotwood explodes off the ball, simply turns, shows him that number eight, looks the ball in, first down. That is execution of the passing game. Both the quarterbacks are rising to the occasion here.
Three in the backfield, including Johnson, who went in motion to give to Conrad. Rob Conrad, a handful, to say the least. 11 yards for the senior fullback, who everybody describes as a tailback in a fullback's body. He has the feet and the hands of a tailback, and he runs as if he thinks he's a scatback.
Indeed he does, and this time Renard Thompson is sealed inside. Good block there by Pilon, 64, and you've got to block that guy to make anything. And one of the most important statistics for a back is yards after first contact. Rob Conrad made 7 or 8 yards after he was hit there.
Hoping to stay healthy this year. Last year, pretty much a disaster because of a variety of injuries. McNabb keeping upended. Helicopters his way to the 35. Fred White from strong safety, turning him inside out. We're inside the final 30 seconds.
One of the things you have to love about Donovan McNabb is his reckless abandon. Some quarterbacks get a little queasy when they hear that option call. Donovan, quite the opposite. His eyes light up. Coaches say every day's a holiday with Donovan. He just loves to play football, and it's reflected in plays like that.
The last play, third quarter. The snap. McIntosh takes the pitch, leaves the block. Got it from Darryl Daniel. And a little room around that right side to the 30 as the third quarter comes to a close. Defending Big East champion Syracuse, 14th in the country coming in. Defending SEC champ Tennessee, number 10. An emotional first three quarters. We'll come back to the Carrier Dome for the fourth in a moment. We begin the fourth quarter, and some question now about Kyle McIntosh, who limped off at the end of that play closing out the third quarter. So the starting tailback for Syracuse for the moment has been replaced by D. Brown as we begin the fourth.
The way the doctors are treating him, he got his bell rung. They're testing his grip, whether or not he has feeling in his hands.
McNabb has to step up against pressure and sacked by Corey Terry. Got a couple today. Check in again, the McGuire watch with Larry Beal.
All right, Dave, Big Mac attack. He homered in his first at bat off of Dennis Reyes, struck out in his second at bat, and reliever Mike Remlinger struck him out again in his third at bat. Reds and Cards still going at it. It's 4-0, McGuire with 60. And we'll keep you posted in his next at bat. Back to the Dome.
All right, Larry. Rob Conrad is the lone setback. They go three wides. And that one almost picked off. It was intended for Spotwood, and Goodrich broke on it. Almost came up with it.
The magnet broke on that ball. He was a great coverage defensive back in high school in Chicago. And he has made his name at the University of Tennessee. This is what you get a scholarship for. Being able to change direction. He backpedals, changes directions, breaks on the ball beautifully. Breaks up the play and very nearly comes up with the interception. That's so difficult to do. It requires enormous body control. Nice play by Dwayne.
He's the magnet because he's got 6 fumble recoveries and 6 interceptions in just 2 years. Touchdown return. So here's a 3rd and 12 for the Orangemen. McNabb will keep. Reverse field a little bit. Stretch and I think get the first down. He needed just outside the 20, and I think they're going to give it to him. Actually, to be more precise, he earned every inch of it. All McNabb. Was that a design quarterback draw?
That was a design quarterback draw in the seemingly endless arsenal. He's going to set as if to pass and explode right up the middle of the field. Good blocking up front. The defensive line's expecting pass. Here he goes. His backs are down the field blocking for him. He's tripped up just enough for the first down. This guy is something special, but we already knew that.
Well, Brown remains the tailback as they continue to rest McIntosh. Al Wilson with the tackle of D. Brown, who is not without his own accomplishments. He had a couple of back-to-back 100-yard games as a freshman against Miami and Pittsburgh. 38 carries, second all-time in school history against Pittsburgh when they had injury problems, as they do again. And let's check in with Dave Ryan on McIntosh.
Yeah, Dave and Bill, the latest on McIntosh. He was hit in the ankle, as Bill said, and you guys saw on the replay a few moments ago. Now the head trainer Don Lowe tells me he's going to be okay, but he hasn't even gotten the helmet back from one of the fellow trainers in terms of him getting back on the field. Lots of injuries happening today in Syracuse in terms of cramps. We've seen ankle sprains. Tennessee has at least 4 defensive players who are regulars or second stringers who are out because of the heat cramps. A lot of them, though, like Al Wilson, coming back into the game.
Well, the latest to limp off, Darwin Walker, and now all 4 starting defensive linemen for Tennessee at one point have limped off.
That is really surprising to me, although this is a different atmosphere and a different environment.
2nd and 11, Conrad. Maybe the 17. So this is 3rd and 7 coming. Big play, as big as they've had all day, trailing by 11.
Vintage football from Syracuse. The trap option. This is only the 2nd or 3rd time they've tried the pure trap itself, where the right guard pulls and kicks out to the left. Conrad popping it up the middle. Tennessee was ready for it. They have really hurt Syracuse's ground game with their stemming, or moving from one front to another after the audible has been called.
Jeff Lowe has checked in as the 3rd wideout.
Here it is again. They move after the audible was called, trying to give them a bad play.
It's picked up. Catch Johnson. Kevin Johnson. Touchdown. Kevin Johnson recruited to compete with Donovan McNabb, among others, at quarterback, and immediately made the move to wideout when it became apparent McNabb would be the quarterback for quite some time. Coach has said he could be a quarterback at, among other places, Nebraska, but he hadn't done badly for himself playing wideout here. 17-yard touchdown to get Syracuse within five, and they go for two to try to get within a field goal. McNabb looking like he wanted a quarterback draw and had no such room. Never a possibility that time. Corey Terry made sure of it, so they settled for the touchdown and stay within 5, 12, 13 to go. Well-known Marshall Street at Syracuse. Students and alumni love to browse, shop, eat, stroll. And inside the Carrier Dome, they love to cheer Kevin Johnson and Donovan McNabb, who have gotten Pasqualoni's Orangemen within five, 24-19. Terrific individual effort by Johnson after the catch, but they were working against Fulmer's second and third team defensive linemen at attrition. All those limp offs taking a toll up front for Tennessee. 8 Trout with the kick. Coming down to Wilson at the 7. And all those speed guys for Tennessee have not done a whole lot of damage in the return game. Here's the touchdown.
Rob Conrad does a great job of blitz pickup right here to allow a 5-step drop against a blitz situation. Al Wilson, boom. Right in the sternum. Linebackers don't like that kind of pickup. Great job by Johnson separating, coming back to the ball, and then finding the end zone in traffic. That is superb execution. I'd say the crowd's back in it.
Lewis has it knocked away, but Tennessee jumps on it.
Unforgivable for a veteran back to let that ball be punched out. You get in this point of the game, you squeeze that ball and you rivet it to your rib cage. Nothing separates it from your body. That ball is switching hands. Most fumbles occur after a back switches hands. Stan Gibbs, number 31, weak side linebacker, punched that ball out. And I'm sure Jamal is coached better than that.
Eric Diagu, the tight end, got the recovery. Lewis, or maybe 4 or 5. Phil Nash, Keith Bullock up for the tackle. It always takes at least 2 to bring down Lewis. 3rd down and about 5 coming for the ball.
Both defenses, Dave, played extremely well for 2 quarters after the middle of the first quarter. Both defenses have been solved and have given up a lot of yards and some points, and now Syracuse's defense is trying to rise to the occasion again.
Bowles almost offside, incomplete for Price.
A lot of adrenaline up here with these 22 guys on the field. People trying to jump off sides or jump up other people off sides. T. Martin shows a little bit of inexperience. He hurries this throw. Not a very good snap and not very good concentration by Peerless Price, who could have caught that ball in his hands.
10 on the line to come after Leverton's punt. Spotwood, the ever dangerous return man. But he has been controlled pretty well, too. 9-yard return, 38-yard kick. Orange men will come back down 5 with 10:18 to go. Well, They look forward to this season opener about as much as any they've ever had in the 18-year history of this Carrier Dome. 24-19, Tennessee by 5, but Syracuse takes over at their 48-yard line, 10-18 to play. And back in the tailback is Kyle McIntosh. Takes the pitch from McNabb. Looks healthy. Nothing wrong with Kyle. First down, a gain of 11.
And another good block by Conrad, who shows he can do more than just run with a ball or catch the ball. He made the key block on the blitz pickup for the touchdown. He made the key block in this option football. He'll be coming this way, as you see. And he seeks out the free safety number 2. Boom, right there. Fred White takes the brunt of the big guy that time.
Kevin Johnson in motion. McNabb finally with a little time. Now has to scramble. Pulls up, going deep for Spotwood. Caught it. McNabb and Spotwood playing backyard ball for 35 yards.
It's just like good fast break basketball. Out on those courts, when the play breaks down, you turn toward the end zone if you feel it, or you go back to the QB. In this case, Kevin goes toward the end zone. Donovan knows exactly where his man is going because they've played so well together for so long, and they love it.
Started with the sack on first and goal at the 7. Play fake McNabb. Throwing back the other way. Incomplete this time. It worked in the first half when they went to Brominski, and this time, just in time, Steve Johnson, back in a corner, came up to break it up.
That's right. Steve had gotten a stern lecture, I'm sure, on the throwback. Very good defensive coaching here and good response from Johnson to play his responsibility, knowing that when they got back in this situation, they might see the throwback again. Steve barely gets there. Outstanding defensive work.
Well, work once. Why not try it twice? They clock down to 1. Got the snap in time. McNabb will keep. Conrad out in front for the block. Touchdown, McNabb. Syracuse leads.
You can't give Donovan McNabb enough credit. Let's also pat that big 44 on the back one more time. He made the key block. He's doing justice. Rob Conrad's doing justice to that 44 today. 2-point attempt. Last time out.
Oh, boy.
That's big.
9:49 to go without any more timeouts for the Orangemen, but they have come back for the lead on Donovan McNabb's one-on-one artistry around the corner. Well, having used their last timeout, the Orangemen will go for 2, leading by 1, 9:49 to go. And this place has got to be fun to coach in, unless you're that guy. You've never been here before, and you have to deal with this madhouse that the Carrier Dome has become. They go out of the eye with 3 wides.
Tennessee changed the front. Donovan changed the play.
Gains it to a pitch for McIntosh. And he got in.
Option football against the stem. McNabb came up, saw the Tennessee defense move, went to his second choice, which was the option, which is the main play that has taken them up and down the field in this second half. Another great block by Conrad, an outstanding running by the once injured McIntosh.
Syracuse by three. Those two doing the heavy lifting for McNabb, who has looked every bit a Heisman candidate today, running and throwing. Donovan through the air today, 21 out of 26, Bill, for 253, two touchdowns.
We act like that's really something special, and it is. But this is a guy who has done this his entire career. You look back on his numbers, they are startling. Only six interceptions with 20 touchdown passes all of last year. Now all he's got to do is bring it on home and finish the job and get this W. These people will love him even more if that's possible.
His goal, get past nine wins. He's won nine every year so far as a starter. Raising the level of expectations for this year. Wayne Goodrich back to accept the touchback. Let's hear from Larry Beal.
All right, guys, want to get right back there. Looks like a great finish shaping up. Quickly zipping around the nation, other scores. Nebraska without starting quarterback Bobby Newcomb. Should be no problem with UAB. They lead 21-7 at the half. Northwestern leading UNLV 34-7. Dwayne Bates with a couple of touchdowns in that game. Central Michigan and Iowa. Khalil Hill, the freshman, has scored on two returns, one a punt, one a kickoff, 21-0 Hawkeyes, and TCU and Iowa State tied in the third quarter. Let's go back to the Carrier Dome.
Absolutely deafening in the Carrier Dome, and that one almost picked off by Phil Nash, intended for Sean Bryson. Oh, he knew he had six.
A major mistake by T. Martin, and he got away with it. Phil cannot believe he can catch this football. He's in coverage here. He's going to read the tight end, be right out in the flat, which is his responsibility, and the young quarterback's going to throw it right to him. Phil still can't believe he didn't gather that in. He was looking at that orange man written down in the end zone rather than the ball.
Martin's numbers today, 6 of 19 for 115 yards. Over the middle, too tall for Price.
Good protection against the clock defense. And yes, the throw is somewhat high, but these great receivers like Price and Copeland have got to start making big catches for this young quarterback. He needs some help out there. He needs somebody to make a play with him, for him.
Their whole concept was don't put everything on his shoulders. Lewis needs a big game. Receivers need to play even above their level with Peyton Manning. First half, they got most of what they wanted. Not really so much here in the second half. Much more has been on the young quarterback's shoulders. And he is fleshed out, going to keep. And T. Martin at midfield. Huge block chase by Nash. Martin with his biggest play of the day.
And Nash is flagged for a shot to the head.
Before the flag, it went 55 yards. Cedric Wilson's block. Bringing T. Martin and look to see 15 added on.
Marvelous job here. When all else fails, use your talent. God-given speed and ability. Not only that, but look at the feel here. Look at the football savvy. Good block out there in the open field by Cedric Wilson and a cheap shot by Nash, something that shouldn't have happened. And these people can boo, but you don't take a shot to the side of anybody's head. Big mistake by Phil Nash. 15 more yards tacked on. Tennessee's right back in business inside the 15-yard line.
Nash, a senior, three-year letterman.
He's still thinking about that dropped interception.
Numbers on the left don't look like Manning, but neither do the numbers on the right. A whole new dimension. Lewis on a cutback. And at the seven.
what that showed for T. Martin was he is able to shake off some adversity, because not much had gone his way from the middle of the first quarter on.
When you have a young quarterback, the thing that you always look for is, what is he going to do when bad things happen? Does he come unglued? Does he do dumb things? This guy has responded by making plays and getting his team in a position to win.
Lewis got five.
Checking off now, changing the play. Sees the blitz coming.
Martin is hoping to be heard on second and five. There's the fade to the corner of the end zone. Incomplete. Intended for Copeland against the coverage of Ian McIntosh, and it's third and five.
Great throw, great catch, great defense. Well executed by everyone. Ian McIntosh is up against a guy 6 or 8 inches taller than he is. Look at that. Got him right on his hip. Look at that vertical jump. That's good football. He comes down out of bounds, and in college football, that is not a touchdown. In the NFL, that's a judgment by the official. In college, you've got to get a foot down.
Fade the other side for Price. Did he hang on? Yes. Touchdown, fearless Price. What a pass by Martin.
Immediately after we said that somebody, one of these receivers, has got to make a play, both of them did. The first one didn't count, but the second one did. Peerless Price. I went to his house to recruit him, and I said, are you? He said, am I what? And I said, peerless. He said, yes, I am, coach. Watch this. This is a great throw and an even better catch. This is not easy. This is years and years of practice together. These guys didn't just start this year working together.
All for the extra point. T. Martin, who had basically been stymied the middle two quarters, comes up with a 55-yard run to set up the go-ahead score. Well, back and forth now. Syracuse has turned to regroup. They had the lead. It didn't last long. Tennessee back up by four. 8.5 minutes to go. One man showed that time it was a terrific throw and catch by Price. But on the drive, all T. Martin, who we were talking with yesterday, said that at one point he was running the run and shoot in high school at Mobile, Alabama. And we said, was it really the run and shoot? He said, not really, just the shoot. Well, he can run too, as he proved.
Yes, he can.
On the one, McIntosh. Little seam up the middle for Kyle McIntosh, who might go. The kicker hole is back. Slowed him just enough for help to arrive at the 24. 74 yards on the return.
This is an example of coming across the field, which is normally a no-no. Too much arm tackling by Tennessee, very uncharacteristic. McIntosh shows enormous courage here. This is a gut check run. He doesn't know how tired he is until he gets run down from behind. This has turned to be a slugfest. The last guy standing is going to win this one.
Really looks like that last one with the ball is going to decide it. Back and forth we go. Now Syracuse threatening. McNabb turned it up for a couple. Let's check in with Dave Ryan.
Dave and Bill, we asked Syracuse players this week how in the world they could avoid losing a fifth straight home opener. They said the summer workouts would make the big difference. Almost every day, almost every player from the program is here on campus doing 7-on-7s, offense, defense, and special teams without the coaches. Guys, it promoted team unity. As Donovan McNabb says, it was like having brothers, 85 of them, from one family. They're really together, ready to go for this game.
Well, they've looked to be the better conditioned team today. The Tennessee starting front four back in. They've had to rotate the defensive line through most of the second half. All four starters at one point have limped off. A lot of cramping problems. Almost disastrous. Conrad jumps on the fumble, and Donovan McNabb has had 3 or 4 fumbles, a couple on exchanges.
Coaches work this stuff so many thousands of times, and I say again, this is inexcusable with a veteran center and a veteran quarterback. especially at this stage in the game, the one thing you have to do is secure your fundamentals, the first of which is the center quarterback exchange.
Five fumbles today by Syracuse. They've recovered three of their own. McNabb incomplete, intended for Quentin Spotwood, who was covered pretty well that time by Al Wilson. Let's get another Mark McGwire update from Larry.
All right, Dave, the latest. A home run and two strikeouts from McGwire. John Hudak on in relief blows him away. So McGwire stuck on 60, one away from tying Roger Maris as the Reds and Cards continue. It's now 5-0 St. Louis. With Big Mac comes up again, you will see it right here on ESPN. And you'll definitely see the Cubs and the Cards on Labor Day, Monday, 2 p.m. Eastern. Does Big Mac set the record on Labor Day? Find out right here.
All right, Larry, another limp-off for Tennessee. This is Fred White, the strong safety.
We talk about not being acclimated to this, but you know, the Syracuse players don't practice over here either. The coaches only bring them over here two or three times, so they haven't, it's not as if they had the advantage of working in this sort of cloistered atmosphere. They just seem to be in a little better shape.
Nate Trout's on, 41-yarder to try and get him within one. Snap and hold and a good kick.
Nate didn't get all of that. He was really glad to see it barely fall over the upright. It wasn't pretty, but it counts.
Kind of like McGwire's 60th today. Barely over the wall, but it counted.
It still counts. He'll take it. He doesn't want to kick it again.
Tomorrow night at 8:15 Eastern, ESPN debuts its first full season of Sunday Night Football in the Week 1 matchup. Oakland traveling to Kansas City to meet the AFC West defending champs. Monday Night Football on ABC from Denver. John Elway and the defending Super Bowl champion Broncos against the AFC East defending champions, the New England Patriots. Sunday and Monday Night Football, ESPN at ABC. Bill Fulmer has all three of his timeouts and a one-point lead. Paul Pasqualoni has no timeouts, and he hasn't had any for some time.
It is a distinct advantage to be in that situation. When you blow your timeouts, whether it's because of equipment or because of 10 men on the field, both of which have occurred to Syracuse, then you put yourself at a disadvantage in a game like this. This is a shootout. This is a flat-out get-after-it slugfest. You need every advantage at your fingertips down the stretch. Both quarterbacks have risen to the occasion. Both defenses are reeling. It'll be fascinating from this point forward.
Whoever wins it has a huge boost going into week two. Syracuse at Michigan next week, Tennessee off, and then they've got Florida in 2 weeks. Trying to end a five-game losing streak to the Gators. Wayne Goodrich with the return up to the 30. Last drive, T. Martin carried for 55 yards, and they tacked on the late hit penalty. His only completion was the 7-yard score. Perfectly thrown fade to Peerless Bryce.
Will Allen, number 25, a corner, starting corner for Syracuse, has been especially effective in special teams today. I thought Goodrich might be going a long way, and Will interrupted him right there at the 30-yard line. It was about his fourth special teams tackle of the day.
Volunteers hoping to string together a few first downs. This will help. There's a first down and then some for Jamal Lewis.
Tennessee has addressed the issue of the Cock defense with power football, lead back football, with their great tailback, their fullback, and rhythm passing, three-step drops primarily.
Lewis, who had 700-yard games as a freshman, including 232 in his first start against Georgia, not quite as spectacular today, 16 carries, 82 yards. Get the feeling he may just get cranking up. They'll put it on his shoulders now. Lewis, another first down plus. into the secondary. Vernon Banks to tackle, 15 more yards as he nears 100.
Very interesting scenario right here. T. Martin looks to the sideline. He gets his play. He looks up at the 25-second clock. Good job by Mercedes Hamilton there, number 75, the left guard. He was chugging like a Mercedes on that one. He bounced Jamal outside, but the young quarterback continues to impress with his presence and his poise.
Play action, steps up to keep, popped it up. And it is covered at the 42-yard line by Syracuse, an Orangeman recovery. Vernon Banks, who backs up at strong side linebacker.
Now, T. Martin is not the only player on the field today that has made this mistake. But when you start up in that briar patch, you put that thing against your rib cage and you put it away. He didn't do that. Ricky Simpkins, number 98, defensive tackle, knocked that ball out. And then it was recovered by 46, Vernon Banks. That's not just a rookie mistake. That's been made by a lot of people in this game. Ball security is the most important thing in football.
Both quarterbacks have had their troubles with it. What a time for a turnover for Tennessee. And a conservative first down call for Syracuse. Rob Conrad for a yard or two. And T. Martin hearing about ball security, I would imagine, in this conversation.
He's on the phone with David Cutcliffe, more than likely, the offensive coordinator and his coach. They have a strong bond. David will calm him down, and he's going to say something like, T, just when you take off, you've got to put that ball away. You must. Here he is. You can almost read his mind. If you've ever done this stuff, just put that ball against your rib cage and squeeze it, son.
Second and nine. McNabb again. Trouble on the center exchange for no gain. That is six fumbles by Syracuse, and I think McNabb has been involved in all but one, and all of his, I believe, have been recovered mostly by him, but it keeps happening.
Coach Pasqualoni may have, he just may have Corey Bowen and Donovan McNabb at midnight in this gym right here snapping the football. I think I might. You just cannot afford those kinds of mistakes, and they've been so lucky that they've come up with the ball and that Tennessee has not.
It's coming. McNabb somehow spins away. How'd he do that? Going deep for Daniel. Caught it. Inbounds. Darryl Daniel at the 10. Hey, Bill, with apologies to Ricky Williams, let's just get Donovan McNabb to Heisman right here.
I think he got it in his hands. Al Wilson cannot believe it. He is clean on the blitz. This is where you destroy quarterbacks, not this guy. He shakes him off. Al cannot believe it. If you could have seen the dejection in his body language when he got up, this magnificent athlete who's showing his erudition, his skill, his presence. And even the coaches get fired up just a little bit, although they're too nervous to show too much.
47 yards. All as he made it up by Donovan McNabb on the fly. Play clock at 2, got the snap, got the handoff to McIntosh, who is at the 8. Remember, no timeouts. They would love to use as much of that clock as possible.
The Tennessee players are having a terrible time with cramps. That's the 10th tackle by Raynock Thompson, number 46. He's struggling. He got something in his calf. Now McIntosh has gone down again. This is a tough football game. Makes you want to play.
I don't know how they can top this. Yeah, 10, 11 more tries at least. They'll have a hard time matching this one. Both of them. Let's see what happens with McIntosh.
Raynock Thompson, number 46, is going to come from the right of your screen. Make this hit. Right there. He must have fallen on the ankle. You can't really see how it might have been bent. but it is definitely the right ankle. And the courageous little guy has gotten about all he can out of that body today, but it has been plenty. For the moment, it does not appear he'll be going back, but nothing would surprise me today.
15 carries, 61 yards. D. Brown, his replacement. And second down, 7 to go. Brown in there, tailback behind the fullback Conrad, and 3 wideouts as they option to Brown. Brown cuts it to the 5, where it'll be 3rd and about 4. Corey Perry and Raynock Thompson combining for the tackle under 3.5 minutes.
The Tennessee defensive coaches now are looking for some courage from their men, and they're getting it. Okay, everybody's tired. We all know that. It's the fourth quarter. We're inside of 4 minutes in the fourth quarter. Corey Terry comes all the way from the backside, sprints the distance all the way across the field, makes the play to bring up 3rd and 4. You do not have to say that this is a big play.
I'll go ahead and say it.
This is a big play.
Stay in the eye. Brown tries to power out all 4 yards, and he got about 2 of them. So for Pasqualoni, decision time, but Tennessee's going to use its first timeout. The Vols will stop the clock at 2:42 to go. And Nate Trout slowly making his way onto the field. That call in order to get the ball as centered for Trout as possible. Orsman, we're out of timeouts. Fulmer calls one, and they get a chance to get organized for the field goal.
I think that's a mistake. I think you make them run out there and kick the thing quickly when they're out of timeouts. Don't let them take their time and get all set. This is a tough angle and a tough location for a right-footed kicker.
19-yarder for the lead is good. It'll be back on Team Martin's shoulders as, again, Tennessee will have to come from behind.
And that's 4 consecutive good field goals by Trout. Good news for the kicking game for Syracuse. Both teams having made mistakes in that area today.
Interesting new era. The last 3 years, there was no question who would have the game in their hands. If Peyton Manning could outthrow people, they'd win. Now there's the element of surprise. It may not be Martin throwing, as he showed. It may be him running. It may be Lewis. You're not sure exactly where, if you're Syracuse, to expect the most trouble to come from.
That's right. Lightning can strike from Team Martin in any direction. He's shown he can throw it with poise. He's shown he can run and go the distance. He's also shown that he can make a rookie mistake, but Donovan McNabb has made just about as many with the center quarterback exchange, and very often that's the center's fault, and that's hard for me to confess.
Coming up next, the Residence Inn College Game Day, all the scores and highlights, plus analysis with Chris, Lee, and Kirk. They're at Notre Dame today. Larry Beal will be in the studio. Full update coming up next on the Residence Inn College Game Day. Tennessee has tried a rotating cast of characters returning kicks, and this time it's Travis Stevens who drops back.
It is the special teams for Syracuse, after all is said and done, that has put them back in the lead, the field goals and the kick return.
A low liner. Over the shoulder catch, Stevens. Tennessee will start at their 17 with 2 timeouts and 2:27 to go after a return of 15.
And Vernon Banks, number 46, is another valiant special teams player, coming up with another big tackle right there. Vernon's a freshman from Rochester, New York. Oh, he's a junior from Rochester, New York.
And he had the fumble recovery courtesy of T. Martin last time he was on the field to set up the go-ahead drive by Syracuse. But Tennessee may have the last word here. They have, as we said, 2 timeouts, none for Syracuse. And about 150 decibels to deal with. Lewis juking into the clear, and Jamal Lewis, Bill, has saved his best for the fourth quarter. 14 more yards to get him over 100.
He has done precisely that, and I can't tell you what a lift it gives this offensive unit, and especially the quarterback, to know that you can hand it off on a draw. Good blocking, good movement up front by the offensive lineman. Syracuse's defense clearly tiring along with Tennessee.
Martin dropping back again, overthrows his target. And he has consistently been guilty of overthrows. This intended for Cedric Wilson. When he's missed, he's been wild high.
Sometimes if you squeeze that ball just a little bit tighter when you're overthrowing, you can bring it down. I'm not sure that he's going to be conscious of little things like that.
Short toss for Bryson, hanging on for dear life, Jason Coles. You know Bryson felt he could break that tackle, but Coles hangs on ankle high. Let's check in with Dave Ryan.
Well, guys, we're talking about the cramp problem. Stan Gibbs, number 31, the linebacker for Syracuse, during that last possession for the Orangemen, was in the locker room getting an IV with fluids. He literally ran back out of the field just as Tennessee took over, got his helmet from an assistant trainer, and hit the field in time for the first play of the drive. They're doing everything they can to keep these guys hydrated and in the game today.
We got back in the nick of time. Tennessee uses its next-to-last timeout.
The crowd made the difference on the last play. That was an audible to a screen. Bryson, the fullback, went out for the screen, but none of the blockers got the audible. The linemen could not hear their quarterback. And when you wonder what happens in audible situations with loud crowds, that's the kind of thing that makes a difference in the game. It's a very real factor.
Our equitable players of the game today, we're going to go with T. Martin, 122 yards through the air, the big 55-yard run to set up his second touchdown pass. Donovan McNabb, obvious selection for Syracuse, throws for 300 and three touchdowns, carries for one as he launches his 98 Heisman bid. Well, the decibel level for this third down snap may be more like 160 or so. Whatever the pain threshold is, we're way past that.
Way past. The only place I've heard like this is Baton Rouge on Saturday night. And he's trying to check off.
Which picked up. Incomplete. Underthrown for Wilson. Fourth down.
I think the Tennessee coaches are going to have to go for it. David Cutcliffe right here, the offensive coordinator. If they want to win this game with only one timeout remaining, they're going to have to try to make this first down. They don't have time to punt it away and stop Syracuse and get the ball back and get it down in field goal range. And here is the football game.
It was not thrown by the nearest official, but it was thrown nonetheless.
And it was a good call. The rule says that contact may not be initiated until the ball gets there. This is clearly contact before the ball arrives. People can boo, and they will, and that's their privilege. But here is the football play. The rule says the contact must occur after the ball arrives, and that is clearly pass interference.
Will Allen,
the offending player, got up and patted the Tennessee player on the back. He did not contest the call.
It was Wilson, the intended target. They live for another series. Lewis weaving to the 43. That should be enough for another first down at a minute 35. And they will move the chains and stop the clock at 1:33.
Here's where the college rules are so effective for the offense. If you can make first downs, it stops that clock. You have time to gather, get at the line of scrimmage, get a call without the noise, and then go to work. If the defense forces an audible, the crowd's right back in it.
They blitz young Martin again. This time it's thrown high, but brought in by Peerless Price. And at the 26, another Tennessee first down for 16 yards.
And the clock stops again with the first down, and the big play guys are making big plays for Tennessee. Peerless Price, T. Martin, are rising to the occasion, and you never know what your men are going to do until they get in this situation. This is great football on both sides.
Ball play for Lewis. Jamal inside the 15. Syracuse defense thought they had him stopped on downs. They have not regrouped since the interference penalty went against them.
They were playing with confidence and aggressiveness, and they've been taken aback here, and that's how they're playing. Tennessee said, we're going to pass protect you, we're going to throw and catch, we're going to make the great catch, and we're going to knock you in the dirt when we have to, and that's what's happening. It's vintage volunteer football. Watch the lead back, number 45, Will Bartholomew. Beautiful blocking.
He stays in at fullback. Lewis at the 10, down to 40 seconds. Volunteers bring it on to their timeout. It'll be second down. All they need, of course, is the best angle possible for a game-winning field goal.
Syracuse cannot stop the clock, and this is all a matter of getting the ball where you want it for your field goal kicker, and I would think that it's real nice right where it is, and it looks like Philip Fulmer agrees.
Well, he will wind it down. Play clock is at 8. 1 second difference. Timeout at 4 seconds. They take their last timeout to get Jeff Hall, the senior from Winchester, Tennessee, on the field to go for the win. Three-time All-SEC kicker. Fourth leading scorer in Tennessee history has the game, which has been at various points on T. Martin's shoulders and then on Lewis's. Well, now it's on the kickers.
It comes down to a kick in so many, many cases, and Jeff Hall has responded so many times for his team. Both quarterbacks have been superb in spurts today. Both of them have made mistakes. Both of the defenses have gone from brilliant to poor, back to brilliant, and back to poor. The special teams have been a major factor. The special teams are the reason that Syracuse is ahead, and they may be the reason that Tennessee wins.
College game day coming up as soon as we decide this one. Tough to find a better way to open their college football season than what Syracuse and Tennessee have presented us with today. Back and forth. A classic, which Syracuse thought they had wrapped up before the pass interference call against Will Allen on fourth down. Ball out of the hold of Benson Scott and the snap of Kevin Gregory. 27 yards for the win. And it is good. Tennessee wins it at the gun. How tough is it to swallow for Paul Pasqualoni, his fifth consecutive season-opening home loss in the Carrier Dome? He thought he had this one won. Everybody thought it was over for Syracuse.
Both teams played valiantly under tough circumstances. All the noise for the Tennessee team with a young quarterback. The Syracuse team came back again and again from mistakes. The coaching staff will get that corrected. This was a great football game despite the errors, a lot of early season errors, but a great start to the season for both teams.
Hard to play any better in defeat than Donovan McNabb did. One more look at the game winner by Jeff Hall.
Keeps that head down, that legs come straight through. A beautiful job when it counted the most. Both kickers performed admirably today, and you got to give credit to number 51, Kevin Gregory, the long snapper, who, after all, as you know, Dave, is the most important player on the field.
Absolutely. Well, in this case, that was actually right. Stunning defeat for the Orangemen. And likewise, Tennessee has to be more than a little stunned to have pulled this one out by one, 34-33. Coming up next here on ESPN College Game Day, for Bill Curry, Dave Ryan, and our entire ESPN crew, Dave Barnett, so long from Syracuse. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. Let's send it to Larry Beaver.